it's more than just a football game and more than just an in-state rivalry. Today, that rivalry for state bragging rights continues. From the Citrus Bowl. The Florida Classic is more than just a football game and more than just an in-state rivalry. Today, that rivalry for state bragging rights continues. From the Citrus Bowl in Orlando, Florida, and it's next on ESPN Classic. We're at the Citrus Bowl in Orlando, Florida for the 30th edition of the Florida Classic as the Rattlers of Florida A&M come in to take on the Wildcats of Bethune-Cookman University. Hello everyone, Charlie Neal along with my partner Eddie Robinson, the former NFL linebacker. When you look at the MEAC, South Carolina State, Eddie, has already wrapped up its second straight MEAC title. Florida A&M still has an outside chance of a berth in the FCS playoffs. But for Bethune-Cookman University, here's a team that's playing for pride, a team that's playing for respect.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Charlie. Florida A&M has won three out of the last four Florida Classics. Bethune-Cookman really wanted to reverse that trend today. And also, with a victory, they can finish 6-5 in a winning record. That's always big. For FAMU, they have outside hope of still getting that final FCS berth, so they're going to play really big to see if they can stay in the hunt for that.
Florida A&M is trying to rebound from a shutout last week against Hampton University. The question today is who will play at quarterback? We're talking about Curtis Pulley, their all-star quarterback. Will he be able to go?
Yeah, Curtis Pulley has showed us so much over the last 2 years, developing from a running quarterback to a pocket passer. But he has to show a lot of toughness today with that groin injury. If he can't go, it's going to be backup quarterback, the redshirt freshman Martin Ope. And he has to really rely on the players around him and just settle down and play within the scheme of the Florida A&M offense.
As far as Bethune-Cookman University is concerned, when you go back to last year's Florida Classic, they shot themselves in the foot by turning the ball over seven times, something they can ill afford to do today.
Yeah, the Wyatt-Bone offense is a very hard offense to defend, but you have to have ball security. That's going to start with quarterbacks Maurice Francois and Matthew Johnson. They have to make the right decisions with the football, and they have to have ball security. They're minus 13 in a turnover margin. If they can protect the football, it gives them a great chance to win.
You know, they started the season 0-4, and out of those four games, they turned the ball over 17 times to start the season. You see what they've done as of late. They're 5-1 over the last six ball games. As far as this particular ball game is concerned, well, we got a lot coming up for you, including Mr. Punt returner himself, Leroy Van. 5 touchdowns he's returned this season, 4 touchdowns, 5 punts. We'll also take a look at the FCS playoff picture. South Carolina State is in, and what would a Florida Classic be without the Battle of the Bands? All that and more coming up when we come back with the opening kickoff from Orlando in a moment.
15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
30th anniversary of the Florida Classic. You see Alvin Wyatt leading his team out on the field. Had a great luncheon yesterday, both teams participating, the presidents of both universities. And one of the things we asked Coach Wyatt, what was his outfit going to be today? He said, it's a secret. If I tell you, I have to kill you, right? Here's the series history, 30th anniversary. Florida A&M has an advantage in the series, 19-10 edge. Bethune-Cookman won 4 of their last 7. The average attendance, over 62,000. And there's Joe Taylor in his second season at Florida A&M. He's the dean in terms of longevity in the conference with over 17, 18, make it 19 years. He had 16 years at Hampton University, second year here, plus 1 year at Howard University. But at one school, Alvin Wyatt has been there the longest. And we're talking about Alvin Wyatt. Here he is in his 13th season at Bethune-Cookman as the head coach, and there is his record. He is 4-8 against Florida A&M. You may have seen the graphic about Joe Taylor. He's 8-4 against Alvin Wyatt, and that counts his time at Hampton University.
Well, Alvin Wyatt is a guy, you know, he's a BCC alumnus, so he knows about the importance of this Florida Classic, so he wants his team to play well in this game every year, and they fully expect to beat the Florida A&M Rattlers.
There he is, and of course, great day weather-wise, not too hot here A week before Thanksgiving in Orlando, Florida, temperature 79 degrees, partly cloudy, 58% humidity, which is pretty low, and the winds are very calm at about 3 miles an hour out of the east-northeast. Why do you look at this game?
Well, I think you have to start off with the Florida A&M quarterback, Curtis Pulley. He's been so much for the Rattlers offense this year. We're going to have to see if he's able to go, whether he starts this game or comes in the second or third quarter. I think at some point we're going to see Curtis Pulley.
Well, we're talking about this being the 30th anniversary of the Florida Classic. There you look at Curtis Pulley. Last year's matchup was all Florida A&M. And, of course, Leroy Van, we talked about him. He was able to put the game out of reach. Here we go with an 83-yard kickoff return. This was in the third quarter, and it goes for a 6. Bethune-Cookman turned the ball over, as we mentioned earlier, 7 times, and the Wildcats got all the bounces. Curtis Pulley had a great game. He ran a through for 2 touchdowns last year and ran for 2 touchdowns, threw for a pair. And there's Leroy Van. He'll possibly get a chance to do something early in this contest, as Bethune-Cookman actually won the toss, deferred, and they will go on defense. Florida A&M will get the ball first in this contest.
And Charlie, you said possibly, and you have to say that because a lot of teams don't kick to Leroy Van. He's that dangerous of a kick returner and also a punt returner. So we'll see the philosophy that Coach Wyatt starts with as far as kicking to Leroy Van or trying to avoid him.
Oh, they're smart not to kick to him. Yeah, they are smart not to do that. So Leroy Van, number 7, awaiting the kick. Bethune-Cookman's Corey Kowalski is the man who's kicking it off. He's a freshman. He's from Rockledge, Florida. Opponents have been returning kicks an average of 22 yards per kick return. It's a short one, and a fair catch called for right at about the 38-yard line. And the man returning it was Max Purcell, the tight end there, number 81. So no return, pretty good field position for Florida A&M to start the game. As you look at Purcell going off there, they're going to probably start the quarterback, Martin Opie, the freshman, redshirt freshman from Titusville, Florida, coming on. There he is, number 16. 6'3", 170-pounder. Make that Plantation, Florida. And they're working out of the I formation on first down and 10. To Sylvester, the second back through. Sylvester trying to reverse his field. Gets across the 40 to about the 41, 42-yard line. So Philip Sylvester, who's had a pretty good career here, a junior, as you look at Opie from Plantation, Florida, first career start. He came on in relief of Curtis Pulley last week. Actually, he came on in relief not only of Curtis Pulley, but Battle, also Eddie Battle, who went down with a shoulder injury against Hampton University.
Yeah, that's important to point out. He's not the second-string quarterback. He's actually the third-string quarterback.
From the shotgun this time, and he keeps it right up the field, cross midfield, first down. Into Bethune territory, inside the 45 to the 44-yard line.
You know, we talked with Curtis Pulley about Martin Opie being ready for this football game, and he said that this kid has actually the strongest arm out of all of the quarterbacks on FAMU roster. And so he only has one pass attempt, so we'll see how that works out today, whether that strong arm can complete some passes.
He ran the ball 5 times against Hampton a week ago, 48 yards. They were shut out in that contest, 25 to nothing. It is first down and 10. Purcell, the man in motion, the tight end going from the top to the bottom of your screen. And here, going up top. And it's incomplete, no flag. And on the reception, or trying to get it to Adrian Smith. Let's look at our impact players, Eddie.
Yeah, let's take a look at Philip Sylvester. He's the talented running back, and they're going to need a big game out of him because of Curtis Pulley not playing a lot. Kevin Elliott, the sophomore receiver, a little banged up. Hopefully he can go today. Dexter Jackson, this guy from a defensive line position, has 57 tackles and 7.5 tackles for loss. He's dominant, and also Antoine Cox. They feel like he can play man-to-man coverage against any of the receivers that Florida A&M have on their roster today.
Every now and then you'll see Leroy Van lined up on the offensive side of the ball. He was that time. On that last play, Sylvester gets the carry. down to about the 40-yard line, just outside the 40. He'll spot it. And it'll bring up a third down situation. And for Florida A&M this year, they're ranked number one in the conference in third down conversions at 44% on 62 of 118. Joe Taylor, 16th coach in the history of Florida A&M, 27th year overall.
And Charlie, this is the first third down conversion attempt for FAMU, and this will really tell, I think, the flow of this game. Will they let the young redshirt freshman throw the ball, or will they do something safe like a screen or something like that?
They're showing blitz. That is Bethune. Pump fakes one side, goes back the other way, and overthrows the intended receiver on the far sideline. That was Javaris Knight. He was trying to hit there, number 15. Senior out of Tallahassee, Florida. So they'll bring up a fourth down, and that'll bring on the punting unit for Florida A&M, and that is Brandon Holdren. So Brandon Holdren will come on to punt it away, averaging 36.8 yards per punt. Mike Williams is deep to receive the punt, and he will not get a chance to return this one, as it is downed by Leroy Van, of all people, right at the 1 yard line, a 39 yard punt. And Leroy Van, there on special teams, pins Bethune deep in their own territory at their own one.
And Leroy Van, I mean, this guy can do just about everything on the football field. Not only is he a great punt returner, kick returner, but he also plays a lot in the nickel and slot. And here, making a big play on special teams, downing that ball out at the 1 yard line. This guy's all over the field.
Well, you won't kick it to me, I'll hurt you. I'll go down and pin you deep. As you look at Francois, he's going to get the start today. We'll see both Matthew Johnson and Maurice Francois in at quarterback for Bethune-Cookman University. They're deep in their own territory. The ball at their own 1 yard line. Jonathan Moment, the lone back behind him, and not much running room as they try to keep it on the ground and go straight ahead with Moment, number 20. Jonathan Moment out of Orlando, Florida, local kid from Lake Highland High. Came into the game with 6 touchdowns rushing. Not a bad showing for a young man who's only touched the ball 53 times.
Yeah, Jonathan Moment, this guy stepped in because Andros Bell was hurt a couple weeks ago, so he was actually a backup also. Bethune-Cookman had a lot of injuries this whole football season, so they're trying to fight through that and still finish off this season strong.
And now Matthew Johnson is in at quarterback, number 13. Hands off to Moment. Moment, not much running room, but gets it out to about the 4 yard line. We're to bring up a third down. And you look at Matthew Johnson, the junior out of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. He was in on that play. And you'll see that Alvin Wyatt is alternating his quarterbacks the first two plays. It started with Francois, and then we came back with Matthew Johnson. Alvin Wyatt, former basketball coach on the women's side of Bethune, was the coach of the year in the MEAC 1 year as the women's basketball coach.
There's not much at Bethune-Cookman that Coach Wyatt has not done. He's been just pretty much all over that whole athletic program, and he's done a great job as the football coach also.
Here's a pitch to the left side, and a good tackle on the far side.
That was number 24, Curtis Holcomb, and that ball looked like it had first down written all over it. But number 24, Curtis Holcomb, give him credit, coming from that cornerback position, making a great play. Just a quick pitch out to the left side, and nobody's there, but all of a sudden, look at number 24.
Oh, yeah, he's
Mr.
there.
Mr. Holcomb.
That was McCaskill on the carry, so to bring up a punting situation from their own 9. So both teams punting on their first possession. And bring on Kowalski again, who does all the kicking for Bethune. He's averaging 38 yards per punt. And Leroy Van standing back inside his own midfield stripe, right at about the 45. And they kick it away from him, but he's going to chase it down. Watch out. They're going to let it die. They don't want him to touch it. They're going to down it right at the 43-yard line. That's pretty good field position. That shows you how much fear he puts in other people's minds. And we'll be back. No score in Orlando.
Now and secure your family's future.
Alvin Wyatt on the sideline talking things over with his two quarterbacks, Francois, along with Matthew Johnson. trying to get things going. Right now, Florida A&M, the ball in great field position at the 43 of Bethune. No score in this contest. 30th edition of the Florida Classic. Glad you could join us as you look at Joe Taylor on the far sideline. Trying to get his team going and possibly get a berth in the FCS playoff. Here's Philip Sylvester going to the right side. Has some blocking over there and is tripped up. Good tackle by one of the defensive backs, Antoine Cox, the left cornerback, who came up and got his hand on the ankle. But there was a good block out there in front. Steve Brazel, the center, number 64, leading the way. He had pulled on the play.
Well, I tell you what, this offensive line is probably one of the best that Coach Taylor said he's ever coached. And as a group, this unit has been very good all year long. You can see the big guys, number 64, Steve Brazel. He's pulling from the center position, which is always hard to do. And they're doing a good job of not only giving Curtis Pulley and the quarterbacks time to pass, but they do a good job run blocking as well.
Play action now. Wide open. And caught. Funderburk for first down. Down to the 17-yard line. Funderburk on the reception. Good for 35.
Yeah, Martin Opie doing a good job with the play action, running a clear out right route by the out inside receiver. And then you see number two, Jarvis Funderburk, just stopping in the soft spot of the zone. And good throw and catching a big first down for the Rattlers.
So the ball spotted right at the 17-yard line. Now we see Leroy Van has checked into the lineup, I believe. Or has he? Yes, he's on the near side at the bottom of your screen. There he's in motion. That's Van. And he's got the ball going around the corner. And he's hit as he tried to turn the corner. Good play defensively, and a flag goes down. Maybe holding, but a good defensive stop that time for Bethune-Cookman. And the man who came up to make the stop was Fanor, the safety. John Fanor. But that's all for naught because Preston Harding, our referee, says it's a holding penalty against Florida A&M.
Yeah, and Leroy Van, man, he took a shot. But if you're Bethune-Cookman defensively, when you have a talented guy like a Leroy Van, whenever he enters into the ball game, the defense has to point him out. Hey, number seven's in the game, he's probably going to touch it. And they do a good job of running the lane, number nine for Nor, making a big hit on Leroy Van.
So this is a young man who plays offense, defense, special teams, everything. Michael Benson, the fullback, is the man who moved over to the other tight end position. This time, the quarterback keeps it, and he's back to almost the original line of scrimmage plus some. Gains about 15 yards, down to about the 13-yard line.
And Martin Opie may making the right decision, just running the zone read, realizing that the end pinched too much, so he pulls it away from Sylvester and calls his own number. And you have to like the way this kid is starting the ball game. Had a couple good completions in the passing game and a couple good runs. Looked like he's going to settle down and be okay.
Opie averaging, well, the team as a team so far, averaging 7.2 yards per rush in this game so far. That's not bad. Second down. And we got movement. Flag goes down. Let's see if it's offense or defense.
Defense offside with contact. 5-yard penalty.
Five-yard penalty, offsides on the defense. You're looking at number 55, Dexter Jackson, the young man, one of our impact players preseason, first team all-conference selection, third year as a starter for the Rattlers, or for the Wildcats, I should say, of Bethune-Cookman University. Rattlers with the ball, first down and 10. For Sylvester, the second back in the eye, behind Michael Benson, the fullback. And it's Sylvester cutting back inside. Dexter Jackson with the tackle right at the 5, but it's a first down for Florida A&M. First and goal. at the five.
You're talking about the rushing attack of Florida A&M, and they're averaging 171 rushing yards per game and 16 touchdowns, but you have to keep in mind that Curtis Pulley, the quarterback that's injured, had 881 of those rushing yards. So, I mean, they're a good rushing team, but a lot of those rushes come by the quarterbacks. That's why it's refreshing to see Martin Opie step in and get some yards on the ground from that quarterback position, because that's what they've been doing all year long.
Second in the conference in red zone offense, Florida A&M. 16 touchdowns have come in the red zone this year. And here's Sylvester. Touchdown, Florida A&M.
Charlie, Phillip Sylvester goes 5'10 and 185 pounds. Look here, you have two Wildcats in position to make a tackle. He just ducks his head, and he wants it more, and makes it into the end zone. That's what you like to see. No fair dodging at the goal line. I see the goal line, I'm putting my head down, and I'm getting the 6 points from a team.
For the point after, Trevor Scott. The kick is up. It splits the uprights. He's only missed one this year. And it's a 7-0 ball game. 6:53 to go. Phillip Sylvester, his sixth rushing touchdown of the season, puts FAMU ahead.
ESPN's College Football, brought to you by Miller Lite. There's light beer, and then there's Triple Hops Brewed Miller Lite. Taste greatness.
Bethune gave Florida A&M a short field. Florida A&M took advantage of it, marching 43 yards. And they did it in five plays.
And Charlie, we're going to have to call that the Leroy Vann effect, because
it did.
They kicked off the, it was a pooch kick to start off the game with a kickoff because you didn't want Leroy Vann to touch it. Then you punt, and you punt it, and you kind of shank it because, once again, you don't want Leroy Vann to touch it. And both times, the field position game favored Florida A&M, and they cashed in and got the early seven-point lead.
And Phillip Sylvester, who last year ran for 93 yards and two touchdowns in this game, has a touchdown already in this contest. Bethune on the return from the 5-yard line and out to about the 24-yard line. Goes Courtney Keith. He's the return man that time for Bethune. About 19 yards on the return. So Bethune will go to work, first down and 10, their second possession. Their first one ended in a punt, three and out. They'll spot the ball right at the 25-yard line. In at quarterback right now is Francois. McLeod is the man moving behind him right there. Joe Morris behind his quarterback at the running back spot. Junior out of Palmetto, Florida, number 15. Here's the option coming to the near side. Flag is down. That may be offsides. Let's see.
Van is trying to be a referee also.
Yeah, I see that.
Put on a striped shirt, my friend.
We have an illegal formation on the offense. Five men in the backfield. That penalty is declined. Second down.
So he did officiate, as you look at that. Alvin White. And again, the impact players starting with Bethune-Cookman.
Yeah, you have to start with Fred McCaskill. This guy is the A-back. He can also make a lot of plays in the running and passing game. Jonathan Moment, the B-back, scores a lot of touchdowns. And Leroy Vann, we've already seen the effect he's had on this ball game. And then Alvis Graham, the sophomore linebacker, who's the leading tackler for the Rattlers.
Pitch to McLeod, going to the left side. McLeod caught from behind, but a flag goes down. We may have a horse collar or hold, one of the two. Good tackle there on the far sideline. And that was Dominski Wilson. Here he is, number 92, redshirt senior from Lake City, Florida. Well, Leroy Vann refereeing again.
There's an illegal formation on the offense. Five men in the backfield. That penalty is declined. Don't throw the play. Third down.
Two plays back to back, same penalties. Fortunately for Florida A&M, were able to play a pretty good defense. But let's see if we can see it.
Well, what they're saying is you have to have you can't have five people in the backfield.
Right.
And so one guy must have to step up to get onto the line of scrimmage, and that's the call.
Illegal formation. So it's third down and 8. Pass. It's complete. Not enough for a first down, though. Complete on the near sideline, and not enough for the first down. As McLeod was on the reception, that'll bring up a fourth down punting situation. So another 3 and out.
And Bethune-Cookman, when you're an option team, you don't do really well when you're in those third and long situations. Your offense isn't geared towards that. But the biggest thing Coach White has to figure out, he has to get those alignments and those formations set up, because the first two plays, there were penalties. And that's something you just can't have in this type of ball game.
Kowalski, his second punt of the day. Leroy Van this time standing right at about his own 35, 36-yard line. And now we've got a flag, a false start against Bethune. So they've been penalized 3 times on this drive in 4 plays.
And that's why the coach is looking like that.
Prior to the snap, false start number 79 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still 4th down.
Markeel Floyd, the left tackle, freshman out of Tampa. Alvin Wyatt, 13th year.
And Charlie, you have to keep in mind, this is a big game. You see a freshman get a penalty like this in the Florida Classic. This is an FCS program. They don't usually play in front of this many people on a regular basis.
Great crowd on hand. Leroy Van trying to get to it, but a good kick by Kowalski, and they will not allow him to touch it. It's going to be down inside the 30 at about the 29-yard line. A 47-yard kick. Back to Orlando in a moment. Seven to nothing, our score here in Orlando. Don't forget this week on ABC, Saturday Night Football, Jeremiah Mazzoli. He's the Oregon Ducks against Mike Stoops. The Arizona Wildcats, with each team controlling their own destiny in their quest for the Pac-10 title and a lead position for Rose Bowl berth against Ohio State. And Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines on ABC at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Some parts of the nation, though, will see Kansas taking on Colt McCoy and the number 3-ranked Texas team. Right here in Orlando, along with Eddie Robinson, I'm Charlie Neal. The Florida Classic, 7-0. Florida A&M with the ball at their own 29-yard line and leading in the contest. And here's the quarterback, Opai, going upstairs. Wide open on the far sideline. Down the sideline for Javaris Knight, and out of bounds. Inside the 25, a good 42-yard pickup.
Yeah, first down is always a great time to do a little play action, but look at number 4, Antoine Cox. He's getting nosy in the middle of the field. He's the cornerback who has that left third. He leaves his position, and you get a big play offensively for the Florida A&M Rattlers.
Longest pass play of the season on the reception, that is, for Javaris Knight. Second longest pass play of the season for Florida A&M. The longest was 49. That was good for 42. This time, keeping it on the ground. And it's Cawley on the carry. Or is that Henry? Demetric Henry, number 23, the senior out of Gifford, Florida, Vero Beach High.
You know, we talked with Coach Joe Taylor about the freshman, Martin Opie. He said, will he be ready to play today? He said, well, Charlie, I asked him, are you ready to go? And he said, well, Coach, I'm wondering why it took you so long to put me in the game. And keep in mind, he's playing behind Curtis Pulley, so you love the confidence of the kid.
Yeah, and I said to Coach, I said, that's like the backup to Tim Tebow, saying, why did it take you so long to put me in here? It is second down. Opai wants to go to the air once again. Takes off and runs. Nothing there. And he gets the first down inside the 15 to the 13-yard line. So good vision by the redshirt freshman out of Plantation, Florida. Remember, the backup, as you said earlier, was Eddie Battle, who got hurt. He's not even dressed for this one.
Yeah, making a great decision, the pump fake and calling his own number. But once again, you have to realize this guy didn't get any practice when he went into the game last week against Hampton with that 25-0 loss. This week, he knew he was going to be the starter. You get a full week of work, and it's just a total mental preparation for a quarterback when he knows those things are going to happen.
Sylvester back in the lineup, second back in the I formation, and now we got movement offensively I believe it was a tight end or somebody on the right side of the offensive line.
Prior to the snap, false start, number 81 on the offense. That's a 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Max Purcell, there's Clarence Pulley on the sideline, number 11, young man who transferred here when Joe Taylor came in last year from Kentucky. We saw the stats on him. 12 touchdowns, 6 interceptions, and that's passing. He ran for 6 touchdowns this year.
Yeah, 18 total touchdowns he was responsible for. The team only has 28 total, so that shows you the impact this guy had on the offense.
Good tackle. Immediately brought down by the linebacker Ryan Lewis, number 15. Sophomore out of Pompano Beach, number 2 tackler for Bethune.
Yeah, Ryan Lewis, he's a good one. This guy has a couple tackles for loss, 57 total tackles, and he plays on the other side of the ball. You know, Bethune-Cookman always have some really good defensive players. I mean, you have some cornerbacks, Rasheen Mathis, Nick Collins, you know, both playing in the NFL. They do a good job of recruiting and getting really good athletes on that defense.
And they have a couple twins back there. And Antoine, we saw get beat a little earlier on that play. And Antonio, his brother, who went out against Norfolk State with a shoulder, but is back. Quarterback in trouble. And he's brought down and a flag goes down. That's Sandilands, number 11 on the stop defensively, Reggie Sandilands. And the sack is all the way back to the 30-yard line. This is a team, Florida A&M, has only been sacked 19 times all season long. Bethune, in the meantime, has only created 13 sacks defensively.
Yeah, but I like the call because you have a freshman, redshirt freshman quarterback.
Personal foul, illegal hands to the face, number 66 on the offense. That penalty is declined. Results of the play, third down.
So Brandon Curry, the guard, or tackle rather, out of Hollywood, Florida. 6'6", 320-pound redshirt sophomore, guilty of the hands to the face. It'll bring up third and long.
Yeah, but you like the way Bethune-Cookman is starting to bring the pressure on the young freshman quarterback. At some point, you can't just let him sit in the pocket and take all day and throw the football. You have to let him know he's in the ball game.
Pressure again. He steps out of it. In trouble. Back to the line of scrimmage. That's it. Fourth down coming. So the last four plays for Florida A&M, a penalty, a 3-yard loss, and 2 sacks.
Keep in mind, after that last big run by Martin Opie, they were all the way down to the 14-yard line, so they were in field goal range.
Yeah, they were.
But the good defense of Bethune-Cookman actually knocks them out of scoring position, and now you have to punt.
And now
Florida A&M, that's their first charge.
Florida A&M takes a timeout. 43 seconds of the time remaining here in the first quarter. FAMU leading 7-0. Joe Taylor wants to talk things over. And fans in Chicago, Boston, Dallas-Fort Worth, you know there's a place for you to go to get the latest on the teams you care about the most. Log on to ESPNChicago.com, ESPNBoston.com, and ESPNDallas.com for local sports, news, radio, highlights, and updates. Right here, 7-0 our game. Florida A&M on top. They started the season with 4 straight wins, beating Delaware State, Winston-Salem, Howard, and then Tennessee State. Their first loss of the season came to Miami, who at that time was ranked number 11 in the nation. In fact, they led in that contest 3-0, but they were held to 29 yards rushing. Then they had to meet South Carolina State the following week, which they lost that one 35-20. They're going to try this field goal. This is going to be a 48-yard field goal, and it's going to be short. Maybe run out. Coming out of it. There's room on this side. Got a wall. Cuts it back. Unfortunately, shouldn't have. Vincent was the tackle of Williams, Mike Williams, running the kick back out of the end zone.
Great decision. I'm going to tell you why. When you attempt those long field goals like that, you have a bunch of offensive linemen trying to cover a kick. They can't tackle Michael Williams. All you have is the kicker and maybe one of the wing guys who are skilled enough to tackle a guy like Michael Williams. So I like the decision of bringing the ball out the end zone. Look at all of the big guys trying to make tackles, Charlie. They can't tackle
But
him.
I thought Williams didn't do a good job of staying up along the sideline. I mean, he let Michael Benson come up and make the stop for him.
Yeah, Michael Benson is still, he's a big fullback. So you have guys who aren't used to making tackles trying to tackle a skilled guy like Williams. It's always an advantage when you can take that ball out after that missed field goal.
So from their own 32-yard line, and then we got all kinds of movement and all kinds of flags, and this is against Bethune. FAMU has only held the ball, held the ball.
False start, number 50 on the offense, 5-yard penalty, and a field first down.
DeLauder, the guard, moving prematurely. 9 minutes and 42 seconds. Bethune has had the ball 4:35. This is their third possession, and they've gone three and out on each one so far.
You have to give FAMU defense some credit. I mean, they're playing good assignment defenses, and that's what you have to do against a wide-bone option attack.
That's the thing we talked to Joe Taylor a little bit about yesterday. And when you, like you said, when you play against a wide-bone, you have three options on each snap. You have the dive man, the pitch man, and the quarterback, and you better hit every one of them.
Yeah, and that's what they want to do. They want to play assignment football. Even if the pitch guy doesn't get it, you still want to put a man on him to let him know that you have. You definitely want to hit that quarterback to let him know that he can't do anything running. But there's also that passing option, too. So Bethune-Cookman, I mean, they're savvy. They're going to change this thing up after a while.
Well, that's the end of one here. 15 minutes in the bag in Orlando. Great crowd on hand. The 30th edition of the Florida Classic. We'll be back. Second quarter, 7-0. FAMU on top. 7-0 our score as we start the second quarter here in Orlando. Charlie Neal along with Eddie Robinson for the 30th edition of the Florida Classic. It is second down and 12 facing Bethune-Cookman. They trail in the ball game 7-0. Their third possession of the day. They have yet to pick up a first down. McCaskill in motion. First pass attempted by Bethune today, and it goes incomplete. That was Matthew Johnson. And down on the sideline, one of Florida A&M's proud alum who played linebacker there. He's a congressman now, Kendrick Meek, representing the 17th Congressional District of Florida. And good to see you here at the game, Congressman.
Well, I'm glad to be here. A lot of excitement down here on the field. Being this close to the Rattler football team, I don't know. I may run out there and pull up, but I'll definitely try to do something.
I saw you with a Bethune jacket on earlier. What happened?
Oh, it wasn't me. It wasn't me.
I thought the president put one on you, Dr. Reed.
Oh, well, you know, it's all in good fun. It's all in good fun. I'm down here, and I know for many of the people that remember my days at Florida A&M, they're walking around with a picture that's on KendrickMeek.com when I played football, and all of this stomach was up here in my chest back then.
Now, Congressman Meeks, before the game, of course, you did the vaunted rallying cry, strike, strike, and strike again. Is that something that they teach all of the alumni when you leave, fam? You did it pretty good.
Absolutely. I mean, I've had a lot of locker room speeches at this particular game, and we would always end up, even when Jake Gaither used to talk to us when I was at FAMU, strike, strike, and strike again. And every Rattler knows that. And we know how to put those fangs out there.
All right, hold on just a moment. We got the Leroy Van standing back there trying to bring back a punt. And he's going to have an opportunity this time. He gets it. Uh-oh, has some room. And he's finally brought down right at midfield. What a hit put on him by DeLauder. Russell DeLauder, number 50, said, "You're not going to go all the way on that one." A 12-yard return after a 32-yard punt. But anyway, going back, there he is. Here's Leroy Van. Five punts he's returned this year for touchdowns. But there's Mr. DeLauder coming over and laying the shoulder pads on him. Kendrick, there's a holding penalty on the play. I know you've followed Leroy Van this year. He's gotten all kinds of national publicity.
Absolutely, and he's a person that's been very potent for the Rattlers. I know that he'll continue to contribute. The Rattlers need to win today to be able to hopefully be in the running. I believe they're 21. They'll be 20 in the pick, especially as it relates to the MEAC, and these kids are fighting hard. Bethune-Cookman is fighting hard to stop them from going, because if you if you win any game in your season, in the season between Bethune-Cookman and FAMU, you better win this game.
that is ensured that the coach will be back next year also, isn't
oh,
it?
Oh, you got that right. Believe me, my freshman year when I came here, we lost to Bethune-Cookman, and the coach was a different coach. Ken Riley then came on.
Yeah, just for clarification purposes.
Yeah, just for clarification purposes.
What is your fondest memory when you played from this particular classic?
Just coming to this game, talking to the fans, alumnus coming through, stopping by the hotel. This is really, really a big game. This is the largest audience that both of these teams will play in front of their entire year. A lot of alumnus here. There are a lot of people here that are second-generation Rattlers and Wildcats. This is really a family reunion. You have a husband and wife. One's a Wildcat, one's a Rattler. It all plays into it. And my mother's a Hall of Famer at FAMU, so it had a special feeling for me to play and let her at this school for 3 years.
Well, we thank you. Go ahead, Eddie. You had a question? Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much, and much success to you and your political career. And I'm glad you could take time to join us here.
Well, thank you so very much. And I want folks to go on and see what I used to look like on KendrickMeek.com.
Well, okay. Well, we showed a picture. I know you don't have a monitor you are. We saw big number 99.
Oh, my goodness. I used to go after me. Quarterbacks feared that number.
All right.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Bye-bye.
Third down. And here is Michael Benson, the big fullback, struggling forward for the first down. He doesn't run the ball that much. He more than any time, anything, catches passes, but he picks up the first down that time.
Yeah, he's the starting fullback. He also double as tight end just a little, and you like to give the big guy some carries. You know when those fullbacks just go in there and they just block the linebackers? Give the big guy a chance to get a couple carries.
First down and 10. FAMU with the ball right at the 45-yard line, their own 45, leading 7-0. Here in the second quarter, here's the blitz coming. Pass out in the flat. Sylvester has some running room. Down the sideline. Puts it back in at the 10. 5. Touchdown. Penalty marker down.
It looked like they're going to call the holding call on number 4, Adrian Smith, the wide receiver, at the end of the play. And it'll be a tough call against FAMU if that is the call.
55 yards on the pass play. The little swing pass from the quarterback out. And let's see. They're going to call a bump in the back. But look where it occurred. They have to do it from the spot of the foul. So it still should be a first down. They'll probably just pick up the touchdown.
Well, don't tell Joe Taylor that, because Joe Taylor wants the touchdown. He doesn't want to hear that spot of the foul thing.
Looks like we have two penalties.
Still.
Well, I don't understand that. Now, the official was not very clear on what he was saying. I didn't understand that. I still don't know where the ball is supposed to be spotted. They're bringing it all the way back. I'm still not sure what he was saying. We never heard a clear explanation of what happened. Let's look at the play.
Well, first of all, Martin Opie just doing great recognition. And that was the last flag towards the end of the play where you saw number 4, Adrian Smith, the wide receiver, delivering that. I didn't see the block in the back. That must have happened early on.
Yeah, there was two flags on the play. It's still a first down for Florida A&M. The ball is across midfield at the 44. They wipe away the second touchdown. It would have been of the day for Sylvester, who runs it for about 8 yards on this carry. Philip Sylvester. And now we got a flag way on the opposite side of the field. Two players going at it. And now number 21, he's battling one of his own players.
Have to keep your poise in the big game. You have to keep your poise. You can't do things outside of the X's and O's.
Number 21 over there for Bethune University, Bethune-Cookman University. That's Slater.
I think he was going at it with number 5, Kevin Elliott. He's a talented wideout for FAMU.
And a penalty flag has been thrown. Let's see who they throw it on, if it's going to be offsetting. But they're going at it. Side judge, and there's 21 still jawing, and now his teammate comes over to try to settle him down, and he gives Ryan Lewis down the country.
Toughness, penalties, five on the offense.
They offset.
And personal foul, unnecessary roughness on the defense. These are offsetting penalties. Second down.
Kevin Elliott, who's been bothered with an ankle injury. There's Slater right there, number 21. They were having a little private conversation over there on the sideline.
They were having a battle within the battle. And we're going to see more of that because that's a cornerback wide receiver, so that's going to be the matchup for the rest of the day.
Second down now. Second, we'll call it one. Back to pass. The quarterback throws wide open down the middle as Purcell, the tight end, stumbles to the floor. First and goal. The junior out of Orlando with just his ninth reception of the year, his longest catch, and that was good for 33 yards.
Great job by the big guys up front. Martin Opie just taking his time and delivering a good ball where the tight end can catch it right up the seam. Take a look here. Purcell, he beats the linebacker, and Martin Opie delivers it to pick number 81. And, hey, I tell you what, he's stumbling and bumbling, and he almost gets into the end zone.
He's about 4 yards shy. He was trying to get there. Sylvester had a touchdown wiped away by a penalty. He is not in the lineup right now. It's Demetric Henry, the second back in the eye behind Michael Benson, the fullback. Elliott in motion. It's Henry. And he's going to be dropped at about the 2 yard line. They'll mark it just outside the one. Big number 76 there, leaning on him.
And Charlie,
that's,
you know,
it's a big wall.
The adage for quarterbacks is that you can't learn by watching. But Martin Opie, I mean, he must have really been paying attention to Curtis Pulley this entire year because he's stepping in on the bicycle like he was on that thing the whole time. He's throwing the ball well. He's making a good decision with the zone read. You like, have to like what he's doing so far as a young quarterback.
Here's Benson. Touchdown. Michael Benson, the fullback. They had linemen in the backfield. They had Benson in the backfield. They had tight ends in the backfield. They said, we're going to take it into the end zone. And they do. Now, the question is, did his knee go down before he crossed the line? Hard to tell there.
Yeah, it's hard to tell, but he scooted on in there, and all he does is score touchdowns. You're talking about a guy, 15 rushes, 13 receptions, and his sixth touchdown on the year, so his touchdown to carry ratio is very high.
False start on the try for the point after. A little sloppy
prior
play.
To the snap, false start number 66 on the offense. 5 yard penalty. Try for point, please.
Now, we were expecting to see Curtis Pulley, the normal starting quarterback, maybe sometime in the second quarter, but.
Maybe not.
I mean, the way Martin Opie is playing with the running game and the rest of the players around him are really stepping up their game offensively. So we may not see, may not need Curtis Pulley today.
Point after is good. 14-0, Florida A&M. Michael Benson, only his third rushing touchdown this year, but his sixth overall. 14-0, FAMU.
One time, let me be myself so I can shine.
Michael Benson, who just put Florida A&M up 14-0. Eddie, before the game, you and I down on the field, we saw him catching passes. He had on gray sweats and a little white t-shirt. Didn't even look like he was one of the players on the team. We thought he was a trainer.
Yeah, I thought he was a trainer just warming up the quarterback. I asked one of the coaches, hey, who's the big kid right there? He said, oh, that's the starting fullback. But he has some real soft hands. I mean, we haven't seen him catch any balls today, but the kid is a pretty good athlete. He
certainly is. 14-0 our score. Florida A&M kicking it off. From the 7 yard line on the return is Keith. Keith gets it back across the 20 to about the 21. A 13 yard return. College football continues tonight with a key game in the Big 12 Conference. Bill Snyder leads his Kansas State Wildcats against the Cornhuskers of Nebraska. The winner tonight earns a place in the Big 12 Championship game. It's college football presented by Hampton Hotels on ESPN and at 7:45 p.m. Eastern. And if you look at the North Division for the Big 12, how big this game is for Kansas State and for Nebraska.
Everything is all tied up, but you like it when you have everything in your own hands. You know, you tell me as a football player, if I can win this game and I get to move on, that's all I want to hear. That's motivation enough for me.
From their own 22. Not much running room for Bethune-Cookman. They have been bottled up all afternoon long. That's a Joe Marsh, number 15 on the carry that time, and nowhere to run. Actually lost about a yard on the play.
But for Bethune-Cookman offense, they just have to get some continuity going, because with this wide bone offense, whenever you have that option attack, all you're waiting for is the defense to make one mistake, one misassignment,
right.
One guy doesn't take the pitch guy, and you have a big play. So you just have to keep being persistent, be patient, run your offense, and when you have a chance to execute a big play, take advantage of it.
Matthew Johnson this time is working out of the shotgun, so it looks like they're going to put the ball in the air. Not necessarily so, though, as Morris is beside his quarterback. And the handoff to Morris. Almost trapped in the backfield. Nothing doing. Big number 99 was there for Florida A&M, and that's Joseph Wims, number 99 on the stop defensively. They have not gotten a first down today. That is Bethune-Cookman. They are still looking to go something more than three and out.
Yeah, Joseph Wims does a good job of tracking this play down from the backside. You know, he's one of those speedy defensive ends, goes 6'5", 265, but the kid can still run. But what's affecting Bethune-Cookman right now is they're not winning on first and second down. You have an option-style offense, and now you're in a third and 12. That's not good.
Yeah, that's not good at all. Third and long, still looking for their first down of the ball game. And now flags, false start, is going to be third and 17. So they shoot themselves in the foot one more time with the penalty. Our referee's been busy today.
Prior to the snap, we have false start. Number three on the offense, 5 yard penalty, still third down.
Nine penalties between the two teams. Five against FAMU, that's the fourth penalty against Bethune.
You know, you talked to Congressman Meeks earlier. You're a FAMU graduate, played with the Rattlers. You know, you have homecoming games and everything else, but this is really the big game for these kids. So maybe it's just a case of nerves early on, but both teams need to settle down with the unnecessary penalties.
Matthew Johnson, pass, ball back in the air. Dangerous situation, and it's incomplete. Falls harmlessly to the turf. 1 of 4 in passing for Bethune today, just 5 yards. Matthew Johnson's pass batted in the air. See who got a hand up.
Number 99, once again,
Joseph Wims.
Yeah. He's having a good first half. If you can't get pressure to the quarterback, always pass rush with your hands up.
Kowalski back to punt it away for the fourth time today. Short kick goes out of bounds. Leroy Van, he's only had one opportunity so far. Didn't get one that time, but he was drilled earlier. We'll be back. You're watching the Florida Classic on ESPN Classic, and one of the best Florida Classic games came back in 2004. We flash back to 2004, shovel pass from Ben Daugherty, the quarterback from Florida A&M, to Rashad Pompey. That gave FAMU a 52-31 lead, but then Bethune-Cookman scored the next 27 points. Rodney Johnson, 15-yard run in overtime. The Wildcats won it 58-52 in overtime. Just two overtime games ever in the history of the Florida Classic. 2004, Bethune won it. 2005, FAMU won an overtime game. Right now, we have a 14-0 score. Another short field for Florida A&M offensively. First and 10 at the 42 of Bethune.
Number 7, Van is in motion.
And they fake it to Van. Quarterback sacked. Not a good looking picture the way he went down, did it?
I think he should have gave it to Van.
Van would have had a lot of room over there.
A lot of room on that side.
The man who came in was Walls.
I mean, look at Van running to the left. I mean, nobody's there with two blockers.
A loss of about 5 on the play. Make it 6. It'll be second and 16. Ball spotted back at the 48 now. They have to get down to the 32 for first down. Purcell, the tight end, moves down to the bottom. Quarterback in trouble. Steps up and runs. Has some running room. Still on his feet. And gets inside the 40 down to the 38-yard line. It'll bring up a third down. Third and about six.
Yeah, you look at part Opay. I mean, he's looking like a young Curtis Pulley to me. I mean, he realizes that, you know, no one is open downfield. He does a good job of avoiding the initial rush, and now he gets them into a manageable situation. A third and six, you know, turned a bad series into a play where they can complete a first down now.
We're still in the first half of play. 8:08 to go before halftime. Opay looking at his wrist, checking things out. On a third down situation, third and six. Looking in the middle, trying to get it to Ike West. The flag goes down. Cox will be whistled for pass interference. That's Antoine. Transfer. Student. Transferred from South Florida, from Killian High in Miami. Antoine Cox.
Defensive pass interference, number four. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot and an automatic first down.
So Antoine Cox, let's look at it once again. Ike West had been bothered with an ankle injury also.
Yeah, he was questionable whether or not he was going to play or not. It looked like he has that right hand just making that contact a little early, but that was a high throw. That's one you just want to. Hey, make the receiver go up there and make a great catch. Don't interfere with him. Just play it clean. If the receiver makes a great catch, hey, it's a first down. You don't want to give him first downs on penalties.
This time, Sylvester cuts it back inside. Sandalin's the first man to hit him there. Farrington also there on the stop, number 90. And offensive lineman Brazel a little slow getting up.
Now, last time FAMU offense was inside the red zone, remember Bethune-Cookman came with the blitz and actually sacked them and knocked them out of the red zone area where they missed the long field goal. So we'll see if defensive-wise Bethune-Cookman will come with some aggressive play calls trying to put pressure on a young quarterback to make a mistake in this situation.
FAMU leading 14 to nothing, in case you just joined us. Curtis Pulley did not start the game. Martin Opay is in at quarterback. Across the middle, complete. Down to the 15-yard line. And that's out of the backfield, or the wide receiver Adrian Smith, as junior from Lakeland, Florida. His 24th reception of the season. And it's going to be third down, maybe one.
And that offensive line for FAMU is doing a great job of giving Opay time to pass. When you have a young quarterback, you have to have the protection up front so he can start to feel comfortable in the pocket.
A lot of people, a lot of scouts here. As Michael Benson is that full back formation. There he is. He got the first down with ease. They bring all those big bodies in the lineup. Number 78 is in there for Florida A&M up front blocking. And he weighs in at a good biscuit over 400.
Yeah, that's a lot of beef on the field right there. But you like what FAMU is doing, because they're running to the line of scrimmage. It's a quick count. So you have a change in personnel. You put your big guys in. You put your big fullback, Michael Benson, at tailback, and then you have it on first down. You go real quick, and the defense doesn't have a chance to adjust.
Franklin Cardo's the young man I was talking about, number 78, actually weighs in at 370. I said 400, but I was off.
He's right there.
Here's the quarterback, touchdown, Florida A&M. Martin Opay, he'll remember that one, his first collegiate touchdown.
That was too easy. That was a great read by Opay, realizing that everyone was going with the zone read. They handed that ball off to Philip Sylvester a couple times already. You set it up, you pull it out, and you go the opposite way and get your easy touchdown.
11 yards on the carry. 21-0 our score. Second quarter. Martin Opie, the freshman, redshirt freshman from Plantation, Florida. First collegiate touchdown. He takes it in from 11 yards out. Team leading 21-0. More information, log on to ESPN.com. Bands getting ready. Battle of the Bands coming up at halftime. Just as big as the football game. Fans don't go anywhere when the Battle of the Bands come up, right?
Oh, no, not in this type of game. I mean, you're talking about the 100th, the FAMU Rattlers, and also Bethune-Cookman and their band, which, I mean, you have to stay here and pay attention to that.
There you look at Martin Opie, the freshman. Let's see what he's done today. First collegiate touchdown. Redshirt freshman. Now Bethune-Cookman down 21-0. Trevor Scott preparing to kick it off. Deep man is Keith, Courtney Keith, freshman from Eustis, Florida. He'll field it at the two. And he's down at the 18. They'll mark it at the 20. An 18-yard return. Let's look at the last touchdown run by Martin Opie.
Yeah, you look at the linebacker, number 15, Ryan Lewis. He's the last line of defense. He stops and goes too fast, and all you show you have a defensive tackle who's in position to make a play and doesn't. The influence of the running back going to the right allows Opie to walk into the end zone for the easy touchdown.
Bethune today only 14 total offensive yards as compared to 224 for Florida A&M. And they have the ball, Bethune. First down and 10 at their own 20. Matthew Johnson, he falls down. He didn't even allow the man to hit him. He just went down. It was Greg Bowler, number 49, there, who was putting the pressure on him. Senior out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania's Northeast High.
I'll tell you what, he wasn't going to outrun number 49, Bowler, so he's firing, figuring, hey, I'll just live to play another play. Why go and put myself in a situation to take a lick from that big guy? But seriously, I mean, Bethune-Cookman has to get something going offensively. They haven't had a first down today. They haven't had a lot of success. They're going to have to change the tempo, maybe go to a no-huddle, speed up the tempo, do something different, because right now FAMU defensively is really dialed into what they're doing offensively.
This is a team, this Bethune team, that started the season, Eddie, 0-4.
Prior to the snap, delay a game. Number 12 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, second.
Michael Adams is in at quarterback. He's a third string quarterback. He's a freshman from Riverdale, Georgia. And we remember we said at the beginning that they, in this game last year, they turned the ball over 7 times. Well, they started the season with 7 turnovers against Shaw University, their first game of the 2009 season. Caught! Somehow, first completion of the day. Javaris Reams, first down across midfield. First completion, first down, longest play, good for 45 yards.
And that's what you need. You need someone to step outside of themselves and make a big play to give you a spark. Maybe that can get your offense going. You're down 21-0 in your biggest game of the year, and you need this right here, a one-handed catch reaching from the backside, and then the run after the catch, a big play for Bethune-Cookman.
They needed that in the worst kind of way, 35th catch of the year for Javon Reams, a sophomore out of Homestead High. Down in Miami, Florida, first and 10 across midfield for the first time today. Bethune back to pass. This one was intercepted almost. Incomplete. In and out of the hands of Anthony Schiff.
Yeah, but incomplete. But give Reams credit. I mean, number 3, Javon Reams, this play is going to be an easy interception for the FAMU Rattlers. Look, he comes from the backside like a DB and helps his quarterback out and knocks it out of his hand. So Bethune-Cookman gets a second chance after that play.
Yeah, Anthony Schutt had it and couldn't bring it down. Matthew Johnson back in the lineup. Quarterback running the offense now for Alvin Wyatt. 4:07 to go before halftime. Here's the quarterback trying to screen on this side. Hit in the backfield, good blocking, and out of bounds, finally on the near sideline goes Joe Morris, the junior out of Palmetto, Florida. So now Bethune trying to create some excitement on this drive after being dormant through the first quarter and a half of this ball game.
I don't even know if dormant. I would say hibernation may be a better word. But here you have the throwback screen, and I don't know if we can see it, but there's a big block right there coming in, and another peelback block by number 56, the center, Eugene Solomon. So Bethune-Cookman, hey, those Wildcats have a lot of fight in them.
Yeah, they've always had a lot of fight in them. They don't give up. Remember, they turned the ball over 17 times the first couple of games. Nothing doing that time for McLeod, trying to go around the right side.
That's number one, Hall, coming up from his cornerback position.
Yeah,
I mean, they're doing a great job. The secondary, you know, Coach Taylor told us they're going to run a couple more nickel and dime packages, trying to get some more cornerback safety type players on the field. But they're doing a good job tackling as a secondary. They're not missing a lot of tackle on the edges. And that's what Bethune-Cookman wants you to do. When they get that pitch and those quick pitches to those wide guys, one player misses a tackle and it's gone.
You saw a shot of George Small over there, former head coach of North Carolina A&T. Here's the quarterback, nowhere to run and nowhere to hide as he was hit by Bowler. There's George Small there. He's the associate head coach here at Florida A&M with Joe Taylor. And that's one of the things, you look at Joe Taylor, he's assembled some pretty good assistants. I mean, of course, he has Earl Holmes and Tim Edwards as co-defensive coordinators. And of course, Earl played many years in the National Football League, and then Lawrence Kershaw is his offensive coordinator. And I want to say congratulations to Lawrence Kershaw and his wife on their new birth that they just had, their first child. It is third down after that loss. Bowler with the big hit. Johnson, the quarterback, and now a flag again. Oh, timeout, actually. Timeout called by
Bethune.
That's their first. They have two remaining. We talked about the fact that they turned the ball over seven times their first ball game against Shaw University. Then they lost to, and they lost to South Carolina State 24-3. They turned the ball over four times in that ball game. So that was 11 in their first two ball games. Then they lost to Norfolk State in a game you and I happened to see up in Norfolk, Virginia. They committed five turnovers in that ball game. That was 16. And then their fourth loss came against Morgan State, in a game they fell behind 17-0. But they only turned the ball over one time, but that's still 17 turnovers in the first four ball games.
Yeah, absolutely, Charlie. I mean, they're still minus 13 on the year. They've reversed that trend, and they've, you know, won the last couple of games and have cut down that turnover ratio to 2.2 a game. But it's hard to win when you have that many turnovers, especially when you're an option team.
Well, you look at the MEAC standing. South Carolina State is already wrapped up a berth in the postseason playoffs. It's just a matter of who they're going to play. The announcement will be made tomorrow. They are playing today. They're playing their last game of the regular season against North Carolina A&T. Florida A&M, of course, playing here. Norfolk State's wrapping up their season at home today against Winston-Salem. Delaware State's playing up at home against Howard University. Hampton University is at home against Morgan. So there were some disappointments in where a lot of people thought things would be this year between Hampton and Morgan, and of course Bethune thought they would be better off.
And, you know, there's always going to be some teams that's going to play above, also some disappointments, but South Carolina State has really been the class of the conference.
This is a big play. Bethune brought down, and again coming up with the stop was Kendrick Washington. There he is, along with help from his friends, Kendrick, a junior out of Sebastian River, Florida, number 97. That's a fourth down. Let's see if Alvin Wye goes for it. Clock continuing to run. A minute 39 to go before halftime. 10 seconds on the play clock. They probably have to use another timeout.
Well, I think the philosophy is that you let the clock run down and then you try to go for it. And if you don't make it, at least FAMU doesn't have as much time to try to convert a two-minute offense.
They already, well, they got the delay of game. I mean, they would think maybe you would be in position to kick a field goal.
Prior to the snap, delay of game, number 13 offense, 5-yard penalty, still fourth down.
I didn't understand that. Did you? Why would you let it run out?
Well, I don't think the intention was to let it run all the way. I think they wanted to let it run down.
Yeah, but, I mean, you have two timeouts left. That's what I'm saying. So it's fourth down. Throw down the middle, and it's caught for the first down. First and goal. Well, it's not going to be first and goal. It's going to be first down right outside the 10-yard line. A 26-yard catch. First will make it the second completion of the day.
That's just
and
a
that's
great,
McLeod.
Yeah, great growing, great throw and catch with the cover two coverage. Nice touch over the linebacker's head and in between the safeties.
First down and 10, Bethune at the 13 of Florida A&M. Johnson to the end zone. That's picked. Curtis Holcomb. Only his first interception of the year. Ill-advised pass by Matthew Johnson, 70 yards on the INT return.
Yeah,
first
Matthew
turnover
Johnson,
of the ball game.
After the great throw on the fourth down play, getting your team in position, you have to realize you have more time in this one play. But hey, that's just a great job by number 24, Curtis Holcomb, just sitting deep, playing his deep third and making the catch and the run. And now FAMU is once again in scoring position. A lot of disappointment on the BCC sideline, but defensively you have to rally up and make a stop here to keep yourself in this ball game. You can't go down four scores before the half.
Right when they were in position to go into the half with 7 points on the board, they turned the ball over inside the red zone. Here's the quarterback throwing in the middle of the field. Right outside. Didn't get in. Nice effort for Javaris Knight, 21 yards, but he's a yard shy of the goal line, but the clock stops with 35 seconds to go.
You have to keep in mind, Charlie, this is a redshirt freshman quarterback, and most of his throws are going to number 4, Adrian Smith, and 15, Javaris Knight. I mean, the main two guys, Isaac West and Kevin Elliott, the two top receivers, have been injured and haven't played much today.
No, they haven't.
Hurry up offense again.
And here's the big quarterback's going to keep it this time. Nothing. No signal from the officials.
It's Benson once again, big 43.
Was that Benson? Did they give it to him? I thought the quarterback kept it that time.
That was a handoff. They come with that heavy extra duty.
We're timeout. Florida A&M.
Now Florida A&M will use their second timeout. There's Michael Benson. Oh, Pi, what a day for the young man. I mean, he gets his first collegiate start, replacing possibly the Peyton Award winner in Curtis Pulley and maybe the Offensive Player of the Year in the MEAC. And he comes through with big, big numbers.
I mean, I tell you what, Charlie, is having a redshirt freshman play this big in the big game, you have to say that this program is in really good hands. But you're talking about passing the baton from a Curtis Pulley to a Martin Opie after his play today, you have to like what Joe Taylor has coming back for next year.
It's kind of interesting. We happen to see Doug Williams' son, who's in attendance at the game here today with his dad. Doug Williams, a former Grambling quarterback. He lives down in Tampa. He's a senior, and he's being recruited by Florida A&M. He's being recruited by Alabama State, your alma mater.
Grambling, of course.
Recruited by Grambling. And, you know, we were kidding with the DJ earlier about, you know, okay, you want him to go to Alabama State, of course, because they need a quarterback.
Right, he's a good player. And
his don't come here.
Guy,
we
right?
Say, don't come here.
Hey, don't come here. This Opie kid is pretty good.
He may be sitting for 3 years, right? So it is second down and goal. Throws wide open. Kevin Elliott. Nobody over there. What's that, the lonely end? The old red plate?
Yeah, what they did is it's the old trick play. You run 11 guys on, and one of them doesn't come all the way into the huddle, and he stands out there, and you get an easy touchdown play. You know, heads-up play by Opie and Kevin Elliott. I mean, he hasn't played much today because of injury, but he still gets the easy touchdown.
I mean, he is so open. So what, he didn't drop it?
Yeah, it's like practice. You know, and he dropped it so quick, I was like, well, did he drop it?
The point after is good. 28 to nothing.
And I tell you, Kevin, those Rattlers, like they say, they strike, and strike again, and they're still striking.
Kevin Elliott, that is his seventh touchdown reception of the year. He had been bothered with an ankle injury. Didn't know, we hadn't seen him play that much, him or Ike West. And he comes up with the catch wide open. I remember the Army years ago used to have what they call the lonely end. And, I mean, he stood out there. Nobody else was within 20 yards, 30 yards of him. Well, that, what that reminded me of.
Well, and defensively, you always have to scan the sidelines, especially the sideline that your opposing team is on, because you have to make sure all of the guys come on. Now, they have to come on past a certain point. You can't trick the defense, but it's up to the defensive guys to realize that the 11th person is standing on the sideline by the numbers all by himself.
18 seconds to go before halftime. And, of course, we talked about the fact that Florida A&M's hopes are still alive in terms of the FCS postseason playoff, and that Liberty was the other team that they're battling possibly for that last spot. Wow. Liberty is trailing in the fourth quarter, late in the fourth quarter, the Stony Brook, at Stony Brook, by 3 points. Should Liberty lose this game, and I'm just a speculation because the committee is going to make the decision, but should Liberty lose this game, it's a very good bet that Florida A&M will gather that last playoff spot, that 16th spot in the FCS playoff.
Well, Charlie, up 28-0, if Joe Taylor goes into halftime and sees that score and it's a final, you can bet these Rattlers are going to come out here and try to put up another 28 points because he really wants to get into that FCS playoff.
So Opai, with his first collegiate start, runs in for his first collegiate touchdown and throws for his first collegiate touchdown. And his team is up 28-0.
And, you know, one thing Coach Taylor talked about was the fact that he really didn't want to play Curtis Pulley today. I mean, I'm sure if this was a 7-7 ball game, we would have seen Curtis Pulley by now. But he's looking at the big picture. You know, if FAMU can get that bid into the FCS playoffs, he wants a well-rested and healthy Curtis Pulley for next week. And, of course, Opai, with his play today, has afforded him that opportunity.
Certainly has. I mean, you may not have to play Pulley. I mean, one of the, if anything, by Pulley not being on the field today, it's the fact that it may hurt his chances for some postseason awards. But it goes bigger than that. As you look at Curtis Pulley, he's got to be happy with his understudy, Mr. Martin Opai, what he's done today. And as they go to the locker room, it is 28-0. Alvin Wyatt, wonder what he has to say to his team at halftime. Who would have thunk it? They were just in position to put some points on the board, but instead of getting 6 or 7, they turn it over, and FAMU converts it. Back with more from Orlando in a moment. We're at halftime here, the 30th edition of the Florida Classic, with the Rattlers of Florida A&M leading Bethune 28-0. And, of course, what would a Florida Classic be, or any HBCU game, without the Battle of the Bands at halftime? You're looking at Dr. Julian White. Dr. Julian White, the director of bands for Florida A&M, a graduate of Florida A&M. So let's go down on the field and enjoy the marching 100. They're about 400 strong. So let the 100 fool you. Thank you.
accompanied by Florida University's concert choir under the direction of Mr. Mark Butler. Ladies and gentlemen, if we could have your eyes to the jungle screen, please.
A&M marching 100 under the direction of Dr. Julian White. Tribute to Michael Jackson. Back to the Orlando in a moment.
Here's one for you.
28-0 the score at halftime here in the 30th edition of the Florida Classic. And it's Florida A&M over Bethune-Cookman University at halftime. Along with my partner Eddie Robinson, Charlie Neal, glad you could join us for this one. And, you know, a lot of people came into this game wanting to see Leroy Vann do something. After all, he had 5 punt returns coming into this ball game. This season alone, he ran back for touchdowns.
Well, Bethune-Cookman, they watch film also, Charlie, and they know not to kick to Leroy Vann. They haven't really given him an opportunity to do much in this ball game.
They certainly haven't. And recently, he sat down with a young man who knows a little bit about punt returns, kick returns. He won a Heisman Trophy. That was Desmond Howard, about the art of returning kicks. About to make it
happen. There he goes.
25-20, he's on.
Leroy Vann,
he's unbelievable.
Leroy Vann, he takes it back to the paint.
Leroy, how do you keep scoring these touchdowns?
Basically, catch and run. I catch the ball once I make sure I got to secure the catch. Once I secure the catch, I just run to where the point of attack is supposed to be at, and then just run until I see no more people in front of me. When I see the ball snap in front of me, basically means showtime.
Are you always looking to break one big?
Every time the ball touches my hand, there's a possibility that I'm going to score. I'm gonna get a long return.
That's over. He's gone. That's a 95-yard punt return.
I had that same mentality. Every time I touched the ball, I wanted to take it to the house. What are you thinking right now?
I gotta secure the ball. Get up under it, get my hands together, secure. Once I secure it, I'm running back between my gunners. My gunners got their blocks.
Down the field he goes.
As I'm running, I get past them, and I see front line, they got their block, so I hit the middle.
He's got a wall.
Now I see me and the punter. I see what sideline I want to go to. I hit the sideline, running full speed.
Kicker's the only one in his way. Here we go.
See the end zone, touchdown, crowd screaming.
So when you were growing up, were there any players who you looked up to or emulated your game after?
I was a 49ers fan. They had Deion on the team. Deion, prime time. I'm in the prime time and everything. I like how you return the ball, so prime time and you.
At the 10, 5, touchdown, Florida A&M. Hey, he's a very special player. We got a chance to talk to him a little bit yesterday. I said, how many tomorrow? What'd he tell us?
He said three, but you like that. You know, punt returners, kickoff returners, you have to go out there with a chip on your shoulder and play with confidence. And like him and Desmond said, every time they touch the ball, they're expecting to score.
Well, you know, you're talking about him being a very special player. Another very special player from an HBCU was Walter Payton, who played his collegiate ball at Jackson State University. And what a career he had, not only in college, but in the pros. And for everything that he's been able to do, they have named a very special award for him among the FCS to the top offensive player.
Yeah, and of course it's called the Walter Payton Reward, and you can look at some of the candidates there. And I mean, Walter Payton was a very special guy. I mean, the things he did at Jackson State and also with the Chicago Bears on and off the field was legendary.
And you look at former winners, you see Dave Maggett, along
Steve
with
McNair.
Steve McNair, Brian Westbrook, Tony Romo was a past winner. But how about some of the candidates this year? You look at the young man from Appalachian State, Amani Edwards, who was a young man who won it last year. You know, there's never been a two-time Peyton Award winner, and Amani Edwards has an opportunity to do that. Dominic Randolph is another young man from Holy Cross University, Pat Grace from Northern Iowa, Terrell Higgins from Elon, of course, Chase Reynolds, and right here, Curtis Pulley.
Yeah, and Curtis Pulley, we haven't seen any of him today. Of course, it was Opie playing so good in the first half. And like you said earlier, I mean, this game probably hurts Curtis Pulley from a chance of winning the Walter Payton Award. But you look at the bigger picture, the fact that they can get into the FCS playoffs, you have to like that.
Well, on the other side, and we talked about the Walter Payton Award, you know, defensively, there's the Buck Buchanan Award, named after a former Grambling State great, Buck Buchanan. And that goes to the Defensive Player of the Year. And there's been some great players out there. You were a defensive player at an HBCU at Alabama State. Did you ever feel that you were a candidate for that award?
Well, you know, Charlie, I had a great year, but I don't think I was a Buck Buchanan finalist. But that award is also a great award, and it's one of those things that Buck Buchanan, great player at Grambling State, also in the SWAC Conference.
Well, you're talking about some of the leading candidates for that Buck Buchanan Award. One of the young men is from Grambling State University. There he is, Christian Anthony. Look at the numbers he's put up for Grambling State University. 72 tackles, 14 tackles for losses, 6 sacks, 5 interceptions, 2 in which he's run back for touchdowns, plus he's recovered 3 fumbles.
Yeah, and the biggest thing about him, Charlie, this is from the defensive end position. Usually you expect a linebacker or a safety to have those type of numbers, but he's a big-time player. You look at some of the other finalists other than Christian Anthony, you have Arthur Motes, also J.C. Sherritt, you know, Mark Legree, and also Austin Lane with 11 sacks. So a couple of good candidates, but I think all the things that Christian Anthony has done, while it's tough not to give him that award, and keep in mind, the award is named after a player that went to his school, Buck Buchanan. So that's also something that bows in his favor.
All right, well, it should be a pretty good second half here. Of course, the Battle of the Bands is continuing. We'll be back, we'll talk about Florida A&M. And don't forget, this week on ABC's Saturday Night Football, Jeremiah Masoli will be leading the Oregon Ducks against Mike Stoops. And the Arizona Wildcats, which each team controlling their own destiny in their quest for the Pac-10 title and lead position for the Rose Bowl versus Ohio State. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines on ABC at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. And right here in Orlando, 28-0 is our score. Florida A&M over Bethune. We'll be back We'll take a look at the Bethune-Cookman University marching Wildcats in a moment.
This is
28-0 our score here at halftime down on the field. The Bethune-Cookman University marching Wildcats band under the direction of Donovan Wells, who is a 1984 graduate of Bethune-Cookman University. Donovan Wells, the band director there.
We invite you to take a look at some Florida classic history as the band plays the music of Grammy Award-winning artist Mr. Anthony Hamilton. The song, The Point of It All. Music arranged by James Portier, directed by Donovan Wells, director of band. Love together, we even get married to one another. Rattlers and Wildcats. The rivalry is still strong, but the love is so deep. Anthony Hamilton's The Point of It All, directed by Donovan Wells and arranged by James Portier, in celebration of 30 years of the Florida Classic. Your 2009 beatdown starts now.
Thank you.
puts a base in it. It's time to stomp these Rattlers. The only reason to stomp a Rattler. It's simply because we can. FAMU tuba players, this is for you. Rattler, put this on Facebook. Now, Twitter that. A stick man, Michael Jackson. What? From the highest of Tallahassee's seven hills. Oh, hell no. Just when you thought it was over. Let me make this perfectly clear, Rattlers.
The Bethune-Cookman Wildcats marching band under the direction of Donovan Wells. 28-0 our score. Back with more from Orlando in a moment. At halftime here in Orlando, 30th edition of the Florida Classic, Florida A&M. It's been all Florida A&M in this first half. They lead it over Bethune 28-0. Along with my partner, Eddie Robinson, I'm Charlie Neal. Glad you could join us for this one. And I'll tell you, what a first half it has been for Florida A&M. They looked like they were going to run away with it. And Bethune had an opportunity just before halftime, but they let that one slip away.
Yeah, they got into the red zone. It was 21-0. And then also, it turned into a 14-point swing because once FAMU got that interception, of course, they went down and put another score on the board. So now we stand at the half with FAMU having a very big lead.
Let's check out some of the first half highlights. It took two possessions before Florida A&M was able to get on the board. And here it is, the first one. Here's Philip Sylvester getting into the end zone. That made it 7-0 in favor of Florida A&M.
Yeah, and FAMU, they come back with their running game. Big number 43, Mikael Benson, the big fullback. You like to see the big guys get a little love running the ball. And, of course, the sensational redshirt freshman, Martin Opie. He's been doing everything right today there. He calls his own number with the running touchdown. And this is the big play that really changed momentum for Bethune-Cookman. They had a chance to get into the ball game right before the half. The interception by number 24, Curtis Holcomb, in the big return. That gave FAMU a chance to put the go-ahead touchdown in the game. And the young quarterback, he won't get an easier throw for a touchdown in this one to number 5, Kevin Elliott. He wasn't covered at all. And that stands us at 28-0 at FAMU with the big lead.
And one of the things you like to see about this young freshman quarterback, Martin Opie, is the fact that his first touchdown as a collegian rushing, first touchdown passing as a collegian, he's done it all in this game and his first start.
Well, I'll tell you what, he's checking off his list. The only other thing he has to do is to get the W, and he may get that too because FAMU is looking pretty good in this first half of play.
And we're getting ready to start the second half. Bethune, who deferred at the beginning of the game, will get the ball to start the second half. From inside the end zone, this is being brought back down the field, and not much running room there on the return for Keith. Let's check out the first half stats. You look at the rushing yards for Bethune, that's uncharacteristic of a Alvin Wyatt Wyatt Bone team minus 6 yards in the first half, and most of those 119 yards in passing came on that last drive.
I mean, they're averaging 158 yards rushing per game with 19 rushing touchdowns. So, yeah, minus 6 yards is an aberration. I mean, there's no way you could have told Coach Wyatt they would have minus six yards rushing at the half. I mean, not a lot of turnovers in this ball game, but FAMU has just come out and executed well, and they've played great disciplined defense against this Wyatt Bone option attack.
So from their own seven, that's where they're going to go to work. That is Bethune, and a quick pitch to the right side. The quarterback was falling down as he pitched the ball, but they did manage to get the ball into the hands of McCaskill, trying to go around the left side, or right side, I should say. Francois is in at quarterback.
Francois, almost disaster. He trips on his offensive lineman, but is still able to get that quick pitch to the edge of the FAMU defense. And Charlie, that's one of the few first downs where Bethune-Cookman has got positive yards. Now you're in the second and three situation, and this is the type of offense they want to play in the second half.
Hey, you want to not have second and long as McLeod tries to go right side, bounces outside after he's hit initially and finally brought down after he gained a few yards by Fabian Wilson, number 38 there. The redshirt senior out of Bushnell, Florida.
And if you're Bethune-Cookman, you know, how do you get back into a football game where you're down 28-0 at half, your offense has done pretty much nothing except for one drive in the end of the second half? Well, you just come back and you play your regular offense. You run your plays, you know, you run your option attack, and you just wait for FAMU to make a mistake. And you may press a little, but you still have to be patient and realize you have to get back into this football game one score at a time.
Andros Bell is in the lineup right now behind Francois. At the running back, McCaskill in motion. Here's Francois going upstairs, but in pressure, under pressure, and somehow spins out and picks up positive yards, about 3 yards on that play. He was bottled up back there. Finally brought down by John Williams, the linebacker.
Yeah, you're trying to go with at least just a little play action on first down, but no one's open. FAMU, great coverage down the field. So as a quarterback, he has a presence of mind just to make something happen. You get a couple yards. Now you're in a second and seven situation. In the first half, they were always second and 12, second and 15. Disaster happening on first down. So they didn't have a chance to run their normal offense.
Yeah, but they didn't get a first down until that last drive of the first half. They got that on a big pass play. Right now they're facing the second down and seven. And here's the throw out in the flat. It's out of bounds. Just a little bit too big for the intended receiver, Ollie Green over there. Ollie Green, the sophomore out of Jacksonville, Florida, looking to pick up his 11th reception of the season.
We'll see if they can maybe connect to Javon Reams, number three. That was the guy in the end of the second quarter who had the big offensive play for Bethune-Cookman, got the fans excited, tried to get them back into this football game. They need someone to step up and make a big play offensively so they could put points on the board.
You know, when you look at this team, other than Ryan Griffin on the offensive line, as far as basically starters are concerned, most of these people will be back next year for Bethune. As you look at Johnson, rolls right, throws, and it's incomplete. He might have been better off running that one, huh?
Yeah, it was right in that gray area. I mean, he had an open receiver, just couldn't deliver a good catchable ball. But he had a chance, like you said, if he would have took off running. But that's the receiver right there. I mean, he made the right decision. He just didn't execute the throw.
Yeah, if you're not going to execute the throw, you may as well run it, right?
Take the chances on the ground.
With the exception of a interception, every time Bethune has had the ball today, they've punted it. Kowalski has been a busy man. This is his fifth punt of the afternoon. Trying to keep it away from Leroy Van, and he does, but to the chagrin of his coach, because it's a great field position, short field for Florida A&M. They'll have the ball, 42-yard line when we come back.
Dad.
Miss Bethune, was that Florida A&M? Miss Florida A&M in her court. Congratulations to those fine students. First down and 10 for Florida A&M. A little swing pass, and now Kevin Elliott throws it. He was a former quarterback trying to hit Adrian Smith downfield. And that's not the first time he's thrown a pass this year. I think he's one of two in passing so far for the season.
Well, well-designed play, but good coverage by Bethune-Cookman on the back end, playing good disciplined defense, playing the double pass.
Yeah, because it's so easy for Isaac Slater to come up and think they're going to run the ball and leave Adrian Smith wide open downfield.
Keep in mind, fam, you already got one cheap score in this game off a little trickery to Kevin Elliott at the end of the second quarter.
On second down, Elliott in the slot to the left. Mikel Benson comes in a tight end spot on the right side, and they hand it off to Sylvester. And he's into the 20, the 10, the 5. Touchdown, Florida A&M. Philip Sylvester, second touchdown of the day, 42 yards on the gallop.
And the FAMU Rattlers, I mean, man, they're just on fire offensively. I mean, Philip Sylvester just takes that ball, and like you said, Charlotte, that was a gallop. He was almost untouched. Great job by the offensive line.
Two plays, 42 yards, 20 seconds. The first one, here's the point after. And so far today, Trevor Scott has been perfect in PATs. 35 to nothing, the score. Here he goes, Philip Sylvester, untouched by human hands. Again, college football continues tonight with a key game in the Big 12 Conference. Kansas State against Nebraska. The winner tonight earns a place in the Big 12 championship game. It's college football presented by Hampton Hotels and ESPN at 7:45 p.m. Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. After being shut out a week ago, Florida A&M pitching a shutout today. It was shut out 25 to nothing. First time that had happened since Bethune shut them out back in 2004. In this Florida Classic, 25-0. They were shut out last week by Hampton, 25-0. Keith at the four. Coming to the near side, tripped up and down side the 20 at about the 17-yard line.
And, Charlie, you talk about that. Let's take a look at the touchdown first. Here is just an inside handoff, just man-on-man zone blocking. The linebackers run too fast, and give credit to the speedy Philip Sylvester, who takes this thing the distance with pretty much untouched.
Two touchdowns for him today. Two touchdowns in this game a year ago against Bethune. He had 95 yards a year ago. He has 75 so far to his credit today, and we still have 11 minutes to go in the third quarter.
And, you know, we talked to him yesterday walking off the field. You know, he played a lot as a freshman. I think he may have been the newcomer of the year in the MEAC or something. So
yes.
He's one of those guys that you seem like he's been here forever. You know, so we said, man, are you a senior this year? He said, nah, guys, I have one more year.
One more year. So, he's just a junior out of Marietta, Florida.
He may have an encore next year.
That should be picked. It is. And coming up with it is Keir Hall with the interception. And for Keir Hall, that's his third interception of the year. Second turnover of the game for Bethune.
Yeah, and the Wildcats, mean the bad snap. The quarterback just, you know, couldn't get settled. And just a great job by Keir Hall just reading the three-step drop and breaking and making the catch. But this play had disaster written on it from the beginning. But, hey, this FAMU defense, you have to give them credit. I mean, this is Bethune-Cookman offense. Isn't a bad offense. They're making them look bad. They're stepping up. They played the run extremely well. And now they're doing a great job in obvious passing situations of playing what the offense is giving them.
From the 18-yard line, first down and 10, FAMU leading 35 to nothing. Here's Sylvester again, tripped up and stumbles forward down to about the 14-yard line.
I would suspect at this point, if you're FAMU, you're going to give him a heavy dose of Philip Sylvester, try to run some time off this clock. I mean, keep in mind, you still have a chance to have a football game next week if you get into the FCS playoffs, which after this win today, which is very impressive, you have a pretty good shot at that.
And we haven't even seen Rocker really in the ball game. Another running back. Dietrich Henry hasn't played that much. These are backup people to Sylvester I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And here's Sylvester again. That was supposed to be an option. The quarterback tried to pull the ball out of Sylvester's belly, and Sylvester just snatched it away from him and made something happen.
Sylvester's like, I'm on fire, man. I'm not giving this thing up. I scored twice today, and I'm looking for number three. But I tell you what,
watch
the
this.
Young quarterback, Opie, if he keeps this ball and go back to the left, it seems like he would have a chance, a better chance than Sylvester to make a big play. But, hey, Sylvester, the junior, hey, look here, freshman, give me that ball. I'm running this thing today.
It is a third down and two situation. A long two, more like three for Florida A&M. Ball resting right outside the 11-yard line. Opie wants to go upstairs, throws in the middle of the field, and it's intercepted. Intercepted. Is that Fenoy with it?
That's number four, Antoine Cox.
So Cox, that was in the receiver's hands, and then it came out, and Cox was the Johnny on the spot, if you will.
Yeah, great job playing the tip drill for Cox.
So first turnover the ball game for FAMU. Let's look at it once again. Whose hands was it off of? Benson.
Yeah, and Benson, you know, told me this big kid had soft hands. He did a good job of catching the ball in pregame. That was a tough catch. Good job by the defender of getting around and tipping that ball in the air. And number four, Antoine Cox with the pickoff.
So from their own 19-yard line, Bethune with the ball, first down and 10. They avoid disaster on that one. Here's a long pass out there. And dropped. Dropped in and out of the hands of McLeod. Jamel McLeod had it and couldn't bring it in. Well, you won't get any better opportunity than that. We saw one great pass reception earlier by McLeod, but he couldn't pull this one down.
Yeah, man, there won't be any let up by this Bethune-Cookman offense or this team, and they're going to play hard. I mean, Coach Wyatt has that type of respect from his players, and here you just have to make that catch. I mean, your team is down big. You have to do something to help your quarterback out. You need a big spark. You need that play to get some momentum going back into this game with your whole team and your fans and everyone.
Well, they couldn't afford to go down 42-0, and let's see if they can pull something out here now. Here's the quarterback on the keeper. Going off to the right side this time, and this does Francois on the carry. Remember, we've seen three quarterbacks play. We saw Adams in for one play, but Matthew Johnson and Francois basically have done the bulk of the work on the quarterback spot. And you know, when you look back over the years at some of the quarterbacks that they've had, is like Souverain was the young man who played last year, Patel Trotman, and some of the guys who've had, they're basically all the same size as far as stature. You have to recruit a certain type of athlete. That is Alvin Wyatt, and size-wise, to play in this type of offense that he runs. You know, Francois is big. He's 6 feet. He's tall for the average Wyatt Bone quarterback. Not much running room there for. There's a flag down. McLeod trying to come to the near side. And we got a flag. Personal foul, and it's against Florida A&M. I'm trying to figure this one out. The referee threw the flag. They sure take a long time getting these explanations out, don't they?
Well, it's probably something away
from
the ball. Had
a personal foul. Hit on a defensive player, number 38 on the defense. That's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
Fabian Wilson.
Yeah, usually a play like that, a personal foul, it's probably something away from the ball that the referee caught. Usually,
I wasn't talking about why is it taking him so long. If the referee threw the flag, he know what the play is. All he has to do is come up and tell us, right?
You would think
they have this long consultation. You don't have to talk to the other six officials on the field, right?
Yeah, personal foul, dead ball foul. You already know it's a 15-yard penalty in the first down.
Now you know they're not going to decline it.
Yeah, you don't have an option to. Yeah, you get it no matter what. Whether you want it or not, we're giving it to you.
Francois back to pass, under pressure. Gets it away somehow. But I'll tell you, the pressure was coming. And there's big number 93 back there who's applying the pressure, and that's Lyman Reed.
And Charlie, just to finish up on your point earlier, I mean, yeah, you definitely need a certain type of quarterback. First of all, you have to be tough. I mean, because your quarterbacks in this wide bone offense, you're going to get hit a lot because you're part of the running
attack.
There
is no personal foul for intentional grounding. There was an eligible receiver in the vicinity. That pass is incomplete. Second down.
So as a quarterback, you're actually a part of the running attack. And so usually, in most years, they're going to have more than one guy. I mean, you would like to have one guy who can, you know, run the offense and do everything, but you're going to take a lot of hits, and that guy may get banged up. So for Bethune-Cookman, you have to have a good quality backup at the quarterback position.
Second down, 10. There may have been a flag that went down possibly with intentional grounding, but they said there was They waved it off. So it'll be second down. Ball spotted right outside the 30 at the 30, outside the 35-yard line at the closer to 36. Coming to the near side this time is Francois, and he is tripped up by Graham. Alex Graham, number 41 there. And there's a player hobbling off the field for the Rattlers of Florida A&M. That's Anthony Shutt, number 36. So to bring up a third down situation for Bethune. So today is 0-for-7. Well, actually 1-for-7 in third down conversions.
And Bethune-Cookman, with the style of offense they run, it's always tough when you get behind two or three touchdowns because you're not a passing team. You're not used to lining it up in shotgun formation. You want to run. You want to run time off the clock. But now you have to go hurry up and try to get a lot of points in a short period of time.
Andros Bell beside his quarterback, Francois, who's going back to pass. With time, this one's knocked away, and it's Van back there on the defensive side playing defense on the receiver. 0-for-15 or 0-for-16 passing. 0-for-6, I should say. 0-for-6 in the last six plays.
Look at Van. He's just playing center field. He's reading the quarterback's eyes, and that's a good job of getting the break on the ball. And Charlie, you know Van and his return skills. If he gets that interception, you can bet he's putting six on the board.
No question. So they'll punt it away from their own 40-yard line. Van is deep to receive it. He's only had a chance to return one so far today. And he got tattooed pretty good on that one. That was in the first half. And now, delay of game.
Prior to the snap. Delay of game, number 16 on the offense. 5-yard penalty, still fourth down.
And some of the penalties that Bethune has picked up today were just senseless penalties, as most of them are in a lot of cases.
Yeah, but you really can't have those delay of game penalties and, you know, the offsides. Those are the type of things that just eat coaches up. You don't like those. There's no time. It's a good time for those type of penalties.
High snap. Hunter just managed Kowalski to get it off, and it's going to go out of bounds on the far side. So, you know, they're going from one side to another with Van not allowing him an opportunity much to return the ball. And don't forget, this week on ABC Saturday Night Football, it's Jeremiah Masoli leading the Ducks of Oregon against the Arizona Wildcats and Mike Stoops, with each team controlling their own destiny in their quest for the Pac-10 title and the lead position for a Rose Bowl berth. But they'll play Ohio State from the Big Ten. Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines on ABC at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific. Charlie Neal, along with Eddie Robinson Jr., the former Alabama State linebacker and NFL linebacker. 7:26 the time remaining in the third quarter here in a 35-0 ball game, all FAMU. This is the Wildcat, but they don't like to call it the Wildcat down in Florida A&M country, because Bethune called the Wildcats. They call it the Rattlesnake.
Yeah,
that was the Rattlesnake they just ran with Philip Sylvester, the Snake.
Yeah, we expected to see, you know, a little bit of this type of offense. Of course, Philip Sylvester, the starting tailback, and look what he's done over his career, and also today. 24 rushing attempts, 93 yards, 2 touchdowns, but it's just a little wrinkle, something to switch it up. And you have Opie doing great at quarterback. You put Philip Sylvester in there and you call it the Rattlesnake. Can't call it the Wildcat. That's the rival team.
Yeah, no way
you can let that happen.
Opie back in at quarterback right now. Benson moving to the right side at tight end. And this is a handoff to Henry. Dimitric Henry practices it back and finally gets a first down and fumbles the ball. And FAMU got it back. They got it back at the 34-yard line. They gained about another 6 yards after the fumble recovery. Kevin Elliott came up with the fumble recovery. I call it the FR.
Yeah, and Kevin Elliott, I mean, he recovers that fumble with five Wildcats standing right around the ball. I mean, great run here. You know, by number 23, Dimitric Henry, he takes the big shot, and the ball is just sitting on the ground forever. You have two Wildcats there who have a chance at it, and all of a sudden, Kevin Elliott, bam, just bounces to him. And just one of those days where all of the bounces seem to be going towards FAMU.
Ball at the 35-yard line, first down and 10. Florida A&M on the move once again, leading 35-0, 6:12 to go, third quarter. Play action. Here's the quarterback decides to keep it. This is Opie, runs out of bounds in front of the Bethune bench. Flag is down on the far side of the field. It's the head linesman runs in. Not a good day for Alvin Wyatt's team, and it's an illegal procedure, and this is going to be whistled against Florida A&M.
They have an illegal formation on the offense. There were 5 men in the backfield. 5 yards from the previous spot. Still first down.
We heard that penalty call quite a few times
quite
in the first
times,
half against Bethune. 5 men lined up in the backfield. First time we've seen that penalty against Florida A&M today, who came into the season ranked second in the preseason poll. The finish behind South Carolina State, who didn't disappoint. They're headed to the FCS playoffs. It's just a matter of who they'll play. Announcement will be made tomorrow. On the pairings, off to the races once again. Here's Philip Sylvester, and Sylvester's down to the 10-yard line. It'll be first down and goal. Florida A&M, 30 yards on that run. He's over 100 for the day.
Yeah, and you have to give the offensive line some credit. I mean, Philip Sylvester, he's hitting the holes, but let's admit it, guys, there's some big holes right there. I mean, he's untouched for at least the first 20 yards. It's the secondary guy that finally has to bring him down. So that big offensive line, I mean, Brazel, Robert Okafor, Christopher Sands, Anthony Collins, Brandon Curry, they're getting the job done today in the running game.
I could have ran through that.
You might have got 5 yards, Charlie.
Yeah, I still would have got through there.
I don't know if you would have busted for 25.
No, 30. No,
maybe
I'm
in
probably,
your younger days.
Yeah, I may have been able to get 6. Opie again. He keeps it this time, and he's not going to get anywhere as he's hit immediately by Lewis, Ryan Lewis.
You know, we saw FAMU earlier in the year against South Carolina State, and one thing Coach Taylor said, this offensive line is probably the best group of guys that he's had in a very long time, and they've only had one injury, and you know, that was to Javier, who was injured the right guard against the Miami game, so they moved Okafor over to right guard, and ever since then, I mean, they've been moving along at a pretty good pace.
Haven't missed a beat.
Right. Whenever you can have the same 4 or 5 guys play game after game, it takes a couple of weeks for that offensive line to get things in continuity. And once you get it there, man, it's a beautiful thing.
Kevin Elliott in the slot to the left side. They try to keep it on the right side on a counter play with the running back. And that is Philip Sylvester on the carry that time. Rozier there to stop him defensively. When you're talking about this team, this Florida A&M team, here's a team that only has about 14 seniors on the team. So he's got a lot of these young people coming back. And one of the things that Joe Taylor was very proud of is that 32 players back in the spring came away with a 3.0 grade point average. And, you know, it's all about student athletes. It's not just about athletics. It's about student athletes. And, again, you know, one of the two teams, of course, Norfolk State, they are the top team in the MEAC in terms of the APR rating. Here's the quarterback. And he's brought down from behind, and we have a flag down. On the stop was Ryan Davis, number 49. See what the penalty mark is all about. That's the APR standing for the academic performance rating. And of course, Norfolk State's proud of that. Pete Adrian has done a great job with that up there. Of course, all of these coaches do a great job.
got Holden on the defense, number nine, after the entry zone, still third down.
John Fenoy, Gene Fenoy, guilty of a holding penalty. That was a third down play.
Charlie, you talk about having 32 guys at over a 3.0, but in Coach Taylor, when he came to FAMU, he said everybody was telling him, hey, if you're going to love coaching the Florida kid. And his thing was, I would love coaching a disciplined Florida kid.
Right.
That's exactly what he has in his program. A lot of disciplined guys. They have 5:30 a.m. workouts in the spring. So they do a lot of things right. And the one quote I love that he says is that we make good social decisions, in the library, in the lunchroom, downtown. And you like to have that out of a program. And the kids are doing good things on and off the field.
Third down and goal. Here's Philip Sylvester, and he'll get down to the one-yard line. He will not get in.
And if you're Bethune-Cookman defensively, unfortunately, as a defensive player, as a linebacker, college, NFL, I've been in a situation where things just aren't going your way. You're down 35-0 and going into late in the third quarter. Right now, you're just playing for pride. They're going to keep trying to score on you, so you just want to step up, get your guys together, and keep them out of the end zone. And do everything you can to lessen the score, and just play tough and play hard throughout this entire game and not give up.
And there again is Sylvester trying to get there. He will not get there. No call from the officials. Was that a fourth down play? Yes, that was a fourth down play.
And that's just a toughness play. If you're the BCC defense, it's like you're up 35-0. You're trying to put another touchdown on me. Hey, guys, let's get together and stop this play. And it's just one of those things that you have to have all the time. You play hard and you play determined all the time. You don't turn that light switch on and off.
But at least I can understand them calling that at that particular junction, because now Bethune is backed up. Here's the play. They didn't get in. They still lead it. 35-0 our score, but a great defensive stand by Bethune with their backs against the wall. And like you said, Eddie, it could be a momentum builder. It could be something that at least lets them walk away with their head held high and not walk away being shut out in this ball game, even though their backs against the wall. The ball first down and 10 at their own 1 yard line. Trying to get some breathing room with the quarterback, who gets about to the 5 yard line. On the keeper, that's Francois on the carry. That's not a bad way to try to get a little breathing room.
Yeah, you just want to get one positive play. You don't want to give up the safety. But, Charlie, football is one of those strange sports, man. You can have a great week of practice. Everything goes well. You practice hard, and you just come out here, and next thing you know, you're down 35-0, and you can't really explain what happens. But you still have to play through that and just keep working hard.
Nothing happening that time as they keep the ball on the ground. Francois giving off to Andros Bell, number 8, the running back. We haven't seen a lot of him today.
So, Charlie, I'm going to put you on the spot here. Martin Opie has had a great game. Of course, hypothetically, if
you're putting me on the spot,
if FAMU,
that's putting Joe Taylor on the spot.
If FAMU gets into the FCS playoffs,
you go with your who got you here?
Well,
who got you here?
Well, Martin Opie got you here.
No. I'm talking about the season.
I'm giving you a hard time.
Who got you here?
Now, you have to go with Curtis Pulley. I'm just.
There's no question. And I'm not on the spot because I don't have to worry
about
wins
and losses. You don't have to make that decision.
But if I did, I'll tell you who I would go with. Great catch up high. And that's Reams, his second catch of the afternoon. And that's good for 25 yards out to the 28, 29-yard line on the first down for the Wildcats.
Yeah, and Reams has pretty much been the long bright spot for this Bethune-Cookman offense. He had a great one-handed catch in the first half, and now you see here he goes up high and makes another sensational catch. But other than him, it hasn't been a whole lot to cheer about offensively for the Wildcats.
Pressure on Francois, trying to skirt to the outside. Gets a little hole and picks up about 6 yards on the carry. We talked about the South Carolina State Bulldogs punching their ticket for the second straight year to the FCS playoffs by winning the MEAC, and they win their season finale today 28-10 over the Aggies of North Carolina A&T as the third quarter comes to an end here in the 30th edition of the Florida Classic. Florida A&M 35, Bethune-Cookman nothing. Got a lot of ground to make up and only 15 minutes in which to do it. It's been a good one here if you're a Rattler fan. Not a good one if you're a Wildcat fan. Back to Orlando in a moment. Well, with a bounce back last weekend in Phoenix, Jimmy Johnson looks to drive into the record books by winning his fourth straight NASCAR Sprint Cup Championship. And the chase concludes with the Ford 400 at Homestead, Miami. And the coverage begins Sunday at 2:30 Eastern on ABC with NASCAR Countdown. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. Along with Eddie Robinson, I'm Charlie Neal here in Orlando at the Citrus Bowl. And it's been all Florida A&M as we start the fourth quarter. 15 minutes remaining. Bethune with the ball, though. And they're facing a second down and about two. I'll call it three. Francois, he has some running room. He's going to take off. And he has the first down, but there's a penalty marker down. And it's sitting right at about the 33-yard line. And it's against Bethune-Cookman. They've had a lot of penalties in this ball game so far today. They've been penalized.
Hold it. 75 on the offense.
Nine times. Maybe that's the 10th one for Bethune. This is a team that came in averaging 75 yards in penalties per game, the third most penalized team in the Mideastern Athletic Conference.
And you talk about, you know, why they haven't had the success this year that they usually have coming into this game at, you know, without a winning record. And of course it's the turnovers. We talked about that earlier in the contest, but also the penalties. Those two things, turnovers and penalties, it really doesn't allow your team to reach its full potential.
No, it doesn't. That one's intercepted. Is that Holcomb again? On the return. If it is, that would, no, that's not Holcomb.
Yeah, 21, Michael
that's
Creary.
Creary on the return that time. That's the second, third interception today that FAMU has picked off. The last one they didn't score on. 14-18, the time remaining in this contest. Third interception of the day thrown by Bethune. We'll be back.
UJ.
35-0 our score, and Bethune has just committed another turnover deep in their own territory. And Florida A&M has the ball, first and 10, inside the 15 at the 14-yard line. Demetric Henry to the right side. Not much there, maybe a yard, and that's it.
Yeah, I know this Wildcat defense. I mean, you're coming onto the game after that, onto the field after that big turnover. I know these guys are fatigued, and they're playing hard out there. I mean, they had that goal line stand in possession before. Now you're coming out here once again on the short field. You're down 35-0 over there. You just keep going out there, and you play hard, play the defense that your coaches have given you, and you just try your very best. And that's what Alvin Wyatt would expect out of these guys, and that's what they're giving them.
Well, they had a pretty good goal line stand the last time Florida A&M was knocking on the door. Remember, the freshman has gone all the way at quarterback now, not
we have time,
being right? Sure Florida of what A&M they wanted from the sideline and from offensive hands. Coordinator Lawrence Kershaw. They call a timeout. You know, we talk about Joe Taylor and his disciples. He has four former assistants who are now coaching at head coaches at the college level. One in the CIAA, Waverly Tiller at Elizabeth City State University. And he has three in the MEAC. Donovan Rose, who's the head coach at Hampton University. Donald Hill Ely at Morgan State University. And Alonzo Lee at North Carolina A&T. So that's saying a lot. And don't forget, college football continues tonight It's a key game in the Big 12 Conference with Bill Snyder leading his Kansas State Wildcats against the Cornhuskers of Nebraska. With the winner tonight earning a place in the Big 12 championship game, college football presented by Hampton Hotels. It comes your way on ESPN at 7:45 p.m. Eastern. For more information, log on to ESPN.com. Charlie Neal, Eddie Robinson, glad you could be with us for this 30th edition, but it's been all Florida A&M. This is a second down. Here's Philip Sylvester turning the corner, diving inside, trying to get a few more extra yards. Sylvester, he's over 100 yards rushing for the day.
And Philip Sylvester has looked really good running the football today. This guy has shown a lot of explosion and burst, you know, some toughness on that first touchdown. It was two Wildcat defenders standing there at the one-yard line. He just powered his way into the end zone. He was banged up quite a bit early on in the season. That's why Demetri Henry and the freshman Eddie Rocker both were getting carries. But now you can see he can definitely tote the load for this offense when he's healthy.
17 carries today, 118 yards, two touchdowns. Not a bad afternoon for the junior from Marietta, Florida. And here he goes again. But black and gold, make sure he doesn't get up a good head of steam. Next to Jackson in there on the stop defensively.
Right, FAMU is going to settle for the field goal attempt.
This will be a 27-yard field goal attempt for Trevor Scott. His longest this year is 43. And he's 3 of 5 from this distance between 20 and 29 yards. This one, no good. He missed that one. So Trevor Scott, sophomore, who transferred from South Florida, from Jacksonville, Florida, still 35-0. Our score here. We want to say congratulations to the Army Strong Award winners that was presented yesterday at the luncheon here in Orlando between the two teams. Cameron Houston, the defensive lineman, a senior from Florida A&M, and I had a chance to sit at the table with Ryan Griffin, the offensive lineman, number the senior from Bethune-Cookman University. Ryan Griffin, number 74, number 71 is Cameron Houston. Offense against defense. Back to pass. This one is incomplete. A little bit too big for the intended receiver, McLeod. He's been the only guy to really look to today, haven't he?
Yeah, McLeod has been there. And, of course, Javon Reams had those two big catches. But other than that, not a whole lot out of the passing game for the Wildcats. But, yeah, keep in mind, they're not a passing team. That's not how they butter their bread. I mean, they came into this game expecting to run the football, 19 rushing touchdowns. But give credit to that FAMU defense of playing well. And you know, Coach Alvin Wyatt, I mean, he's been here for a couple years and, you know, right man for the job. You know, he's been doing a really good job this year, just kind of fell on some bad times with all of the turnovers. You have to correct that. Once you correct the turnovers, I think it'll be business as usual for the Wildcats.
5 of 18 passing so far today. That's a good catch on the near side. And roll out of bounds, and that's Reams again.
Reams once again, yeah. He's been the, like I said, he's been the lone bright spot for this offense, going up and making the good catches in the first half and now here again in the fourth quarter. Good job going up high in traffic. And usually they only want Reams to make a couple of big play catches a game, because ordinarily in a tight ball game, they would stick with this wide bone option attack and would be content to run the football. But being behind, now you're forced to pass.
Now again in trouble, Francois steps out of a couple tackles, still on his feet and bowling people over, and picks up about 9 yards on that run. Boy, what a run by the little fella, Francois. He's really not that little at 6 feet, 195 pounds.
Yeah, but you like the effort and determination. You're talking about a quarterback coming into the game and you're down 35-0 in, you know, top of the fourth quarter, but you're just running through guys. You know, I'm not going to be denied. I'm going to keep working hard, and FAMU kind of a shoddy job of tackling, you kind of have to keep your poise defensively if you're the Rattlers. You know, just because you have a big lead, you can't just sit there and think the game is over. You have to close the deal.
It was about six people that had to touch it before he finally went down. That's pretty good. Here's a pitch to McLeod coming to the near side, and McLeod back to the line. Well, he gets the first down right at about the 44-yard line. McLeod. And you talk about some of the postseason awards as far as the Mideastern Athletic Conference is concerned. You know, I believe as far as the offensive player of the year, we're looking at probably a three-horse race. Of course, we talked about the fact of Curtis Pulley from Florida A&M. And you can't forget LaMarcus Coker from Hampton University, who going into their game today against Morgan State had 969 yards rushing. Now, they lost to Morgan today. That is Hampton University 16-13 after shutting out Florida A&M a week ago. And then you Will Ford, South Carolina State. I mean, you can't forget what he's done to get his team into the FCS playoffs and win the MEAC title for the second straight year. 870 yards, seven touchdowns rushing for him and two touchdowns receiving. So it's going to probably be between those three as far as the offensive player of the year in the conference. This week on ABC Saturday Night Football, Jeremiah Mazzoli and the Oregon Ducks go up against the Arizona Wildcats, with each team controlling their own destiny in the quest for the Pac-10.
But you know, SEC always seems to, every year now, they're getting at least one team in that national championship game. You know, Florida and Alabama should meet undefeated. Of course, one of those teams will make it again.
There's not much fooling on that play. They read that one all the way, the defense did. When you talk about Florida, they still, with that 10-0 record, they still have to play Florida State and Alabama. You know, Alabama still has to play Auburn and Florida. Of course, Texas playing Kansas today, and they have to play Texas A&M in their season to try to stay unbeaten. TCU already won today. They beat Wyoming, and they have New Mexico left to stay unbeaten. Cincinnati plays Illinois today, and then they end the season against Pitt. That should be a good game there between Cincinnati and Pitt. Dave Wannstedt's team, Boise State, they're playing Utah State. Then they've got Nevada and New Mexico State, and then Georgia Tech at 10-1. They close out the season against Georgia. Here's a completion down to the 40-yard line.
I think you have to look at it. I mean, it's pretty much a three-horse race, you know, with Florida, Alabama, and Texas. Unless something weird happens, you would expect that one of those SEC teams would probably play Texas, unless Texas slips up and get a loss. Of course, then you have an undefeated TCU. And, you know, you can say it's only 2 or 3 weeks left for college football, but a lot of things can happen in 2 or 3 weeks.
Well, no question about that. So a completion to Ollie Green. Gets the ball down to the 40-yard line, down to the 9:05 mark. That's what's left in this contest. Francois throwing out to the near side, and it's McLeod on the catch. McLeod a bit 2 or 3 yards on the catch, and that's all he's going to get.
You know, Charlie, I don't really believe in moral victories in football, but I think it would be important for Bethune-Cookman, you know, to get a score on the board. You know, it's, you know, 35-0, 35-7. Yeah, fam, you should go on to win this game. It really doesn't matter. But, I mean, for the 59,000, you know, 418 fans in attendance, half of them are Bethune-Cookman fans, they want something to cheer about before they leave. I mean, the band put on a great performance, but you want your football team to at least, you know, keep fighting hard, and they're doing that. And you have to give credit to Coach Wyatt and his staff. I mean, even though your team is down, not having the best of years, you still go out there and you compete hard all the way to the last tick off the clock.
No question about it. High snap now. Quarterback pulls it down, runs with it, gets some positive yards, still on his feet. Francois hit pretty good down there about the 10-yard line, but he gets a first down, a 30-yard run for the quarterback. Francois out of Palm Bay, Florida, and Bayside High.
Yeah, and Francois, I mean, he's playing like this score is 0-0. We've seen him early with a couple determined runs, and here, I mean, he's finishing this run.
Good little pop there, and
yeah,
of course,
shot.
Bethune trying to avoid the shutout.
We talked about the quarterbacks with Bethune-Cookman. They have to be some tough cookies. I mean, they're going to take some shots. When you run into option attack, you get into the open field like that, you're just like a tailback or a fullback, and you have to duck your head and get those extra yards.
Keeping it on the ground, Bell straight ahead. Andros down to about the 2-yard line. The lowest amount of points that Bethune scored this year was 3 points. And that was in a 24-3 loss to South Carolina State. They're trying to avoid the shutout. There's still a lot of time left. And, you know, they just blew a golden opportunity just before halftime when they were driving down the field and they throw that INT. And Florida A&M came back and converted at the other end, a 14-point swing. And that play alone. And straight ahead. A touchdown is signaled. And as Andros Bell taking it in for his second rushing touchdown of the year. So the shutout is averted by Bethune. And that was a pretty impressive drive by Bethune-Cookman. 9 plays, 99 yards. Remember, their back was against the wall. Yeah. And it's blocked. The extra point is blocked, so it's 35-6. With 6:57 to go, Francois takes him down the field. But it's Andros Bell who takes him into the end zone. They go 99 yards. They avert the shutout. 35-6 the score.
Struggling with credit card debt?
Back here in Orlando, Florida. That was actually an 80-yard drive. That drive started at their own 20, but still it was an impressive drive. And the one that was a 99-yard, which was the previous time they had the ball, resulted in an interception. Moon coming out here, quarter moon. Gorgeous night here in Orlando, Florida. And now, of course, Florida A&M expecting an onside kick. Leroy Van standing back at his 30-yard line. He's only touched the ball one time today as far as a kick returner. And he picked up a few yards. This one will be, he's going to field it. Watch out. Watch out. Now they bottle him up right at the 38-yard line. If he could have gotten to the outside, it might have been all over.
Well, he's one of those special players, Charlie. Every time he touches the ball, everybody just holds their breath because you don't know what he may do with it.
So Florida A&M leading 35-6. They get the ball. Just checking out some other scores in the MEAC today. Delaware State closed out their season with a 30-20 win over Howard University. Morgan knocked off Hampton 16-13. Norfolk State beat Winston 28-21. And South Carolina State wrapped up their season. Their only loss of the year was to South Carolina, an FBS school, and they beat North Carolina A&T today 28-10. First down and 10. And again, with a win like this for Florida A&M, it has to have some type of impact on the committee, the selection committee for the FCS playoffs. You know, they've lost, what, 3 games coming into tonight's ball game. They lost to Miami, who was the number 11 team in the nation at the time. They lost to FCS-ranked team, South Carolina State, and then they had the hiccup last week against Hampton University.
Yeah, like Coach Taylor told us, they lost to 2 top 10 teams. You know, 1 FBS,
1 FCS.
Correct.
And here we go. That's Rocker, the freshman.
Oh, good move.
Look at him, still on his feet. Eddie Rocker out of Ocala, Florida. First time we've seen him today. He goes 43 yards.
Yeah, but you talk about, you know, FAMU, back to their chances of getting into the FCS. I mean, they have a pretty good shot. I mean, just because of the players they lost here, the run by the young freshman Rocker, you know, getting there and getting his chance. But that one loss, I mean, I saw that score last week and that loss to Hampton. No disrespect to Hampton, but I was like a 25-0 loss. What happened? And then I read the headlines. Well, Curtis Pulley was hurt and the backup was hurt, so you had to play with a third-string quarterback. So, you know, luckily the coaches are the ones that decide. They have a lot to do with the vote as far as who gets into the playoffs, and they may be somewhat understanding to that fact.
You're right about that, Eddie. Of course, Coach Taylor will tell you, when you ask him what happened, he says, He started when we got off the plane.
Yeah, he said the nor'easter was coming in from Virginia. So that was pretty funny. But that, I mean, you're playing with a third-string redshirt freshman quarterback on the road, and you can understand why they lost 25-0.
Not thinking he's even going to play.
Going to play, yeah. But you see, I mean, this kid, I mean, he's played extremely well with a week of work. I mean, Opie has had a sensational game for a redshirt freshman getting his first start. So you can see what type of team the Rattlers have. But, hey, you can't just throw out one victory. You know, every team would like to just throw out one, you know. Let me get a do-over in week nine, and we're back into the national championship race. It doesn't happen that way. You have to count all of the games in football.
And, of course, one of the teams that they're looking at in terms of getting that possible final berth would be Liberty from the Big South Conference, who lost today to Stony Brook by 36-33. So that opened the door.
Makes
the fact that Florida A&M is winning big over Bethune in this Florida Classic. That opens the door.
But that's the score there that Joe Taylor wanted to see. He wanted to see Liberty lose to Stony Brook. Of course, they don't get an automatic bid in that conference, so now it's all up for grabs, you know, with the at-large bid.
Going to the air. And a flag is going to be thrown.
It may be offensive. It seemed like he was pushing off.
I know. It's
good judgment call by the ref.
It's going to be an interesting call here. Slater was on the defensive side of the football. FAMU receiver. Out there. And, of course, there's the discussion.
A lot of discussions today. We're taking a look at. Well, here goes the call now.
We have offensive fans. Number 80.
Yeah, that's just what you call.
Yeah, that's a good call. I like that because it seemed like he was the one that was initiating the contact, and that defender has a right to the football.
So there's Slater.
But you talked about,
well,
here goes the play here. Opie trying to go up top and can't see that then, but the receiver did most of the pushing off in that scenario, and I think the referee got it right. So, Charlie, you know, you take some time to have a discussion, but when you make the right call, don't you forgive him for that discussion time?
That's okay on that. But some of these.
The personal files, you don't want a discussion, right?
I mean, certain things you don't need to discuss.
You know, and as we have a small break here, you know, look at South Carolina State. We talked about them earlier. I mean, I think they give the MEAC probably the best chance that they've had in a number of years to compete in the FCS playoffs and to get a couple W's. I mean, I really like the team that Coach Buddy Pough has, clearly the class of the MEAC, and I think that's a team that can go into the playoffs and play extremely well. I mean, they're solid at all positions. You talked about Will Ford, but, you know, quarterback, wide receiver, they have big-time players across the board.
Well, it's going to be very interesting to see what happens. And, of course, you know, you've got the CAA, who's got a lot of teams out there.
Always have a lot of teams.
You know, they have one team that probably that will win, get the automatic, and then there's probably three other teams who will probably go into the FCS playoffs. You know, you get the Big Sky might get two at-large teams. Here's Opie with some room, takes off runs. Down the middle, and tagged at five, down to the two. Opie with a big run with 3:50 to go. Good for 26 yards.
Man, this kid is smooth. It doesn't look like he's running fast.
No,
but
it
yet
doesn't.
No one is catching him, you know. And you like that type of player. He seems to be so effortless in what he does. Here you drop back pass, no one's open, deep, and then you just start taking off, and you're just moving faster than everyone else, and no one can catch him. Like, he just runs past guys like they're standing still.
He takes it down to the 1 yard line. Possible six more points going on the board for the Rattlers. Rocker, the second back in the eye. And they give it to Rocker, and he's in the end zone. Touchdown, Florida A&M. So Eddie Rocker, with only his second rushing touchdown of the year. Freshman from Ocala, Florida. 38-yard, make that a 62-yard drive.
Rocker with just a simple inside handoff. And we talked about the big guys up front for FAMU getting the job done all season long, and especially today. You have to give all five of those guys a pat on the back.
Going after is good. 42-6. The Rattlers of Florida A&M. Second most points they've scored this year. They scored 48 against Howard University.
These freshmen, you talk about Rocker, you saw him come into this game and do some good things, and also, you know, quarterback Opie. I mean, what a great future. I mean, this class here in a couple years, man, they're going to be dynamite once they really get things going. But young guys are stepping up and making big plays, and you have to love that if you're Joe Taylor.
Well, again, like I said, 48 points was the highest points that they've scored this year, and they did that against Howard University. Of course, Curtis Pulley has not been in the lineup as of yet on the sideline, but he's got to feel good about what his team has done so far today.
You have to feel great. I mean, Curtis Pulley, I mean, here's the guy that came into this game with 18 touchdowns. I mean, 12 passing, 6 rushing. So 18 out of the 28 total touchdowns he was responsible for. So a guy that does that much for his team, and the rest of the guys are playing well without you.
And, of course, Bethune backed up again, 3:09, the time remaining in this contest. And, you know, one of the things we've talked about the FCS playoffs. We've talked about who might be here, there, who might be the leader for Offensive Player of the Year in the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference. How about the Heisman Trophy this year? I mean, it's not a clear-cut thing right now.
Well, I think it's a lot of guys out there. Of course, Tebow, Colt McCoy. I think one of those two guys probably would get it. And you have to see how they finish out the year, and that'll be the biggest thing. But, you know, like you said, it's a toss-up. You can go either way, and you can't be wrong.
No, you can. I mean, there's Mark Ingram, there's Keenum. Of course, you said Tebow, there's Colt McCoy, C.J. Spiller. And, you know, Alabama player has never won the Heisman Trophy. So Ingram, you know, he's sitting in there waiting.
Well,
this is incomplete.
That's a good trivia question. I think if you would ask the average fan that, they would probably guess that someone from Alabama has won the Heisman Trophy.
Right. Colt McCoy coming off his best game of the season last week. And then, of course, C.J. Spiller, he was banged up early on in the season. Tebow, you know, he doesn't have the numbers, but he's Tebow, right?
Defense and pass interference, number 2. Spot foul, automatic touchdown.
And the penalty is against Florida A&M.
Bethune-Cookman, you know, 2 minutes, 40 seconds left in the game, still trying to put points on the board. You know, Wildcats never die.
Well, you're not supposed to. You never give up the fight till the fight is done, as they say, right? Well, you know, you're talking about those people that are possibly Heisman Trophy candidates. They're on these top teams. I mean, look at the BCS standard.
It always goes back to you have to be on the good team. And football is one of the ultimate team sports, you know. Everybody has to play well and do their job as a team.
Francois trying to get some running room on the far side and trying to get to the first down marker. Finally run out of bounds in front of the Florida A&M bench. And, of course, you know, you talk about some awards that is coming up in the postseason. I mean, the best player award, Maxwell Award. You know, Tebow won it the last 2 years.
Right.
Other people have won it. Brady Quinn, Vince Young, Eli Manning, Drew Brees, Peyton Manning. I mean, there's been some.
He's saying there's a big correlation between that award and NFL success, maybe? Yeah,
apparently. Apparently. And, of course, you've got people who are candidates this year like Javid Best and Cal and Jimmy Clausen and Noel Devine and Tebow, of course, Golden Tate, Shipley, Colt McCoy. I mean, it's going to be pretty interesting who gets the best player award this year. This pass is complete to the near side on the third down play. Let's see if they're going to go for it, try to keep it going on fourth down.
But you know what? Those individual awards, I mean, you always hear guys think their teammates first. And, you know, football is one of those pure team sports. You know, there's no Michael Jordans in football. You can't have a star running back. If you don't have guys up front, I don't care how good of a quarterback or running back you are, you won't be successful. So it's always a team sport first, but you do have individual achievement within the team concept.
No question about it. How do you like for the top quarterback award? You know who won it last year?
Who's that?
Sam Bradford.
Okay. Well, I think still, I mean, I think the top quarterback may be Colt McCoy. But, you know, that kind of fourth down play here. And
they're going for it on fourth, and they're going to come up short. With a minute 20 to go. You know, Matt Barkley's a candidate, semifinalist for the Davey O'Brien Award for the top quarterback. Dan LeFevre from Central Michigan has put up some great numbers this year. Of course, Tebow is in there. Tony Pike got hurt for a couple of games, but I think he's going to be ready.
Yeah, if you go by just, you know, pure numbers, then I think it kind of opens the race up. But do you go by pure numbers or you go by the success of the team also? And
well, when you look back,
the debate you go back and forth with.
But when you look back over the history of the Davey O'Brien Award, Brigham Young has had four winners. You know, four people out of BYU have won that award. Florida and Oklahoma have had three each. And, of course, we've got the Peyton Award that's coming up as they keep the ball on the ground with Rocker. Rocker, the freshman, is Joe Taylor getting the Gatorade bath. He says that. No matter how warm it is here in Florida, that still is cold.
Well, it was warm today. It was 70 when the game started, but it's probably in the 50s right now. So that.
Well, we say congratulations to Joe Taylor. There he is standing there.
Oh, he's totally off guard.
Oh, yes, he is.
Yeah, he had no idea. Come on, coach. You got to be smarter than that. You've been around for 20 years. You win the big game.
That's two
you
got to
expect it coming.
That's two of his offensive linemen, Anthony Collins and Christopher Sands, who came over
and throw up a towel. There you go.
Oh, fumble. And recovered by Rocker.
Well, I think, you know, FAMU is going to go on to win this football game, so you have to congratulate Joe Taylor. But the bigger picture, and I'm sure Joe Taylor is thinking about it right now, is he wants his team to get into this FCS playoffs. And,
yeah.
They're going to be really on pins and needles tomorrow. Hopefully they'll get in. I think, you know, with Curtis Pulley and the way Philip Sylvester has run the football today, I think they'll be a good opponent, a good candidate to get into that FCS playoffs. And, you know, once you get into the playoffs, Charlie, all bets are off. You never know what can happen.
Well, let's say we hope that they will do a good job. The committee will recognize the efforts put forth by Florida A&M throughout the 2009 college football season, and in doing so, give them an opportunity. Of course, Liberty lost today, and that's no guarantee, because you never know how committees think. We know what happens in basketball when they select the teams for the NCAA tournament. It's 64 teams. There's no automatic. I don't care how well you think you've done and how well you think or how much you think you should be there, it's still nothing automatic.
Well, the one thing about it, at least you have one of your coaches, Joe Taylor, is on the committee, so maybe that can help.
Well, the thing is, he can't vote for his own team.
Yeah, there you go. He can try and influence.
Your thoughts on today's game? Of course, Bethune-Cookman didn't come with their A game today. They had struggled a little bit. They started the season 0-4. They won five of the last six and came in here, you know, with a lot of fight in them and a lot of high hopes.
Well, Bethune-Cookman, they played hard. Of course, they're going to finish without having a winning season this year. But I mean, I think you have to give the credit to Opie. I mean, the young freshman, I mean, this kid came in here and was sensational. You didn't know what to expect with Curtis Pulley doing all the great things he did all last year. I mean, all this year, you never would have thought that this young redshirt freshman would come in here and have this type of game. And the rest of the players around him, they really stood up and they made big plays on the reception and also with Philip Sylvester running the football. But Opie and the offensive line, definitely the story of this football game.
Yeah, he threw his first collegiate touchdown pass, ran in his first collegiate touchdown pass. I mean, he did it all with his legs, with his arm, and his teammates helped him out. Martin Opie, you see the numbers on him today. Not a bad day.
And not a bad day for a guy who was a third-string quarterback 2 weeks ago. Like he told Coach Taylor, I'm trying to figure out why I wasn't playing all year long.
Well, you know, one of the things you got to figure, he was a redshirt freshman coming in. If he hadn't played, they could redshirt him again.
Right, that's true.
And you know, with them losing Pulley after this year, he would have been sitting right in the catbird seat.
Yeah, but I think this guy, I mean, coming on for the next 3 years, you have your quarterback of the future secure, and you never would have got that chance to see him play for him to have that experience in this big game if not for the injury to Curtis Pulley. So everything is kind of working out good for Joe Taylor. All they have to do now is get into the playoffs.
Joe Taylor continues to roll up no matter where he goes. He puts his mark on the program, and they are successful. Joe Taylor with another winning season. Let's look at some of the final stats from today's ball game. Of course, we know that Sylvester ran for over 100 yards, and Florida A&M rushed for 268 yards. They passed for 151 to come up with a 419 total yardage for this contest. First downs 19-11. And, of course, Bethune-Cookman turned the ball over three times in the ball game. They turned it over seven times last year, only three times this year, but still they were costly turnovers.
Well, that FAMU defense came to play. I mean, you talk about this Wyatt Bone option attack, and FAMU defense played good, disciplined defense. They didn't give up any big plays, and they got the turnovers. I mean, you have great players like Curtis Pulley and Sylvester. Sometimes you forget to talk about that. The defense shows up to play every week for the Rattlers.
Well, 59,000 plus came in to see this 30th edition of the Florida Classic here at the Citrus Bowl in Orlando, Florida. And if they were Florida A&M fans, they didn't go away disappointed as the Rattlers put 42 points on the board in a 42-6 victory over the Wildcats at Bethune-Cookman University. Well, Eddie Robinson Jr. and our entire ESPN production crew, Charlie Neal, saying so long from Orlando in the 30th anniversary of the Florida Classic, where Bethune-Cookman falls to Florida A&M 42-6. Florida A&M ends their regular season with a record of 8-3, 6-2 in conference play, while Bethune-Cookman falls to 5-6 overall, 4-4 in the conference. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. So long from Orlando.